I just want to welcome everybody to the March 29th meeting of the Deerfield Finance Committee here in South Deerfield, Massachusetts. Just getting things underway. I get a couple of copies coming off the back. And I'm sorry, Jeff, you were saying? Or?
No, I just wondered, as far as one question I had, and I know you were conversing with Zach, as far as this RFP that
right.
they're putting out.
Right.
Do you know if that includes square footage, that building, the RFP includes square footage for a meeting room, a training room?
I do not. I have, Skip is printing out the questions and responses that, the responses to our questions from last week, and then a couple of follow-up questions, just so everybody has everything.
Okay.
Those details were not in there, so I'm sure tomorrow will be a good place to ask that question.
Okay, great. Right. Thank you.
Okay, so I guess we'll get started just looking at the minutes from last week, from March 22nd. I think all you guys either have them or have had a look
mm-hmm.
at them. Are there any things that seemed off or missing? I know a lot of it was kind of qualitative recreation of our conversation with South County, which was extensive, but I think a great, a productive meeting.
Mm-hmm.
If there's no comments on that, I'd entertain a motion to accept the March 22nd.
I make a motion.
Thank you.
I'll second it.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, great. So on to this meeting now. What we're planning to do this meeting is go through a number of budgets that we've talked about in the past, that we had specific things we're waiting to have answered or verified, or we voted already, but there was some change
yep.
higher
mm-hmm.
or lower that either is small in size or obvious as to intent. So if any of these start to get slowed down and we have more questions, we can put them off. But our hope is to go through these in fairly short order and then move on to Kevin and the wastewater treatment plant. And then I believe John Pareski will be joining us and go through the capital items as well. Doug is not going to be with us tonight, as you guys may have noticed. But he'll be back next week. So any Doug-related items,
thank
we
you.
Can
mm-hmm.
catch up with him on.
Okay.
And I guess before we start that, I'll just describe what Skip is handing out. Thank you, Skip, for making those copies. So this is the list of questions that Tom Feidenkevich had sent to Zach and Matt Russo as a result of our meeting last week. So I think all these things in purple are things we had brought up and talked about. A number of them have at least some amount of answer to them. The next thing is three questions that I sent back to that same group as kind of a follow-up. And then the last page are some answers to those questions. So not all this is definitive, but at least is some information as we try to get ready to come to a consensus on this budget and this service. All right, with that, I'd like to move on, and I know you guys are going to want to spend a lot more time on that, but I'd like to move on to going through these budgets, if that's okay with everybody. The first budget that we had to go over was the Selectman Administrator Expense.
Okay.
If anybody has the agenda for tonight, I have the account numbers on there, but this one is account number 122-5400.
On 22-5100?
5400, the expense.
Selectman salaries?
Next one.
Selectman administrator expense.
That's 5110.
No. Selectman okay. administrator expense.
Yeah, 5110, I see selectman staff salaries. This is selectman administrator expense, which is the one after
which,
that.
Yeah, it's 122-5400.
Right. So let's see. So this is an item that we had previously voted and has been lowered by $750.
So what's the number now?
The number now that we'd be voting tonight would be $9,500 for selectman and administrator expense. Trying to remember if Doug had mentioned where the change was.
Yeah, I don't have the old one.
I believe it's just out of the general administrative expense meetings column, but I actually do not know for sure.
Yeah, it looks like he shaved it out of there, 300 of emergency planning, just a little bit here and there.
Yeah, I can see from last year. I don't have the old one that had the 10,250, but anyway.
They probably have it someplace, but it's fine. Unless there's objections, I'll move the 9,500.
I'll second that.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? No. Okay, the next budget is the assessor's clerk salary. This is budget number 141-5110. So this item we had not brought up before. This is for the assessor's clerk, and it is just a 1.7 COLA increase to last year's salary.
I have a question on these. Mary, where is it in the personnel bylaws that we get to make salary increases when it's above the step 10?
I don't believe it says anything in the bylaws.
One way or the other.
One way or the other.
So but the classification plan lists the maximum salary.
Right.
How do we exceed that, since the town meeting has already voted a maximum salary?
They voted maximum salary, but they also voted a 1.7 or whatever COLA increase.
That's a change to the classification bylaw.
I'm just saying that's what they've been doing, is voting.
I understand.
For step 10 to have, because we don't have any other provisions for people who have been here longer than 10 years.
That was my argument that I spent a whole 45 minutes of your time.
Mm-hmm. And I still don't have an answer to it, other than the fact that that's voted every year.
Well, I think Skip raises a good point. I think that is a good item to have on the agenda for the joint meeting we're looking to have with the Select Board to talk more specifically about the process of COLAs, how that fits into the Personnel Board, the town bylaws, the classification schedule, and then the process and result of what the actual percentage is every year. I think that's certainly a conversation we want to have. Would you be comfortable with having that conversation at that point in time, as it's related to a number of step 10?
No, I think so. I think probably what I'll ask Doug to do is to run it past town council, and so maybe by the time we get to that
we can
have something.
Okay.
And since this is the assessors are a board that's elected, and I suspect, like the school committee, they may have some autonomy in this one, so
you want clarification on the policy?
Yeah.
Find out if there even is one.
Okay. We can certainly follow up with that. I think that is a good point, something we can tighten up for this year and beyond. If there are no other questions on the assessor's clerk salary, I'd entertain a motion to pass. I see the number as $51,049.
Mm-hmm. I'll move.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, the motion passes, or the recommendation passes, I should say. The next budget is the Conservation Commission. That is budget number 171-5400. This is another budget that had not been brought up before. I'm not sure why. I don't think this was prepared when we went through the smaller line items. This is requested amount is 800, which is unchanged from last year.
It's been unchanged for,
except for 2015. What happened there? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know what happened.
I would have thought this one would have been one of those that we would have taken up. In any event, I'll move it unless this. Somebody objects to
second
or wants to discuss it.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any other question or anything? No. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right. Next one is the Open Space Committee, 172-5400. Similar to the last. Similar to the last one, this was not prepared when we went through the small line items. The requested amount is 250, unchanged from the last two fiscal years.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next one is the planning board, budget number 175-5400. It's the next one in your packet. This one, again, we had not taken up before. Requested amount is 7,500, again, unchanged from last year. Looks like this amount, this budget has kind of drifted down over the few years before that to this level. And, you know, FY15, the last numbers we have, it looks like just under 7,000 was expended.
Make a motion to move this 7,500.
Second it.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, the next one is town office expense, 192-5430. That's 192-5430. Now, this is a budget that we had brought up before. We had recommended an amount of $27,500. This budget has been amended a couple times since then. Mm-hmm. I think the one you guys may have and that I had was $23,500. Is that what you see in your packet?
Yes.
Okay. The actual amount that has been amended from that is $25,500. So still lower than our original, but higher than what we're looking at here.
And so where is the increase?
The increase is in telephone. Doug looked, that telephone had been moved from 10,000 down to 8,000. And as he looked at some phone bills, he did not think that would cover it.
Right.
He thought that the bills themselves would be closer to 9,000, 10,000.
So the number is 25,500?
Right. How does anybody feel about
that? I make
a
motion, we approve that.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, great. So that was for 25,500.
Right.
Mm-hmm. All right. The next one is general insurance, budget number 196-5400. That is the next one in the packet after the one we just talked about. This was a budget that was not prepared. We have not looked at this one before. There is roughly exactly a 5% increase that came from the insurance. This is general liability insurance to the town, and the town has been told to estimate 4 or 5%. As we looked back over, you know, the previous years, we've been pretty good at estimating. They don't feel that, you know, this is a bad estimate, although obviously it's not going to come in, you know, right on the screws. Mm-hmm. Obviously, that's a bigger increase than we'd like to see. This is really ramped up from, you know, FY11 to 14. You're in the 50s, and all of a sudden we're at, you know, almost pushing 75. So, you know, we'll certainly be looking at our options for different carriers or different ways to have this sort of insurance and try to restrain the costs, or at least the cost increases. But, you know, Doug, I just spoke with him today about this one. He felt that, you know, while it was certainly not ideal, this was kind of the best they thought they could put forward for this year.
Mary, do you know what this is for? What's covered in general insurance?
Liability.
Well, the liability of the buildings and anything that happens to the buildings is in.
But it's also fire insurance, or
it's general on all the buildings. Yeah.
Okay.
This includes. I thought it included other buildings too, like the library and stuff like that. But I'm.
I do not have a building list.
Yeah, I would think so.
You know, the library and the senior center, because I noticed that
the DPW
facility has been taken out on the line to show that it's been increased by that. But I think it does include the Tilton Library and the senior center.
Yeah, you wouldn't go out for separate policies.
No. Well, what I will do.
No, it's not less expensive bundling them together. Mm-hmm.
Well, what I will do is just confirm with Doug, you know, what buildings are covered under these policies, as this is the only line item of this sort within the general town budget. I know there's separate liabilities and scams and other things, but I would imagine it's encompassing, but we will, I'll ask that question and get us that answer.
It'd be great to have kind of a footnote on these things every year, you know, that just explains it, not in detail, but just kind of an overview.
We can ask for that, a paragraph that goes with this format for the following year.
This is for blah, blah, blah.
Sure. And usually, it used to do that.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah.
I assume that this does not cover, I assume this does not cover the school.
No.
I don't think
but
so.
But I don't know where that one is. It should that be with the school.
School budget.
Okay.
But it's amazing, though, every year it just goes up and up and up, though, doesn't it? But do we have any claims?
Yeah.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah. The only, well, I guess,
rarely go up.
The only thing I can say is, you know, I'm sure you guys as well, but on the personal level, I'm seeing the same thing with different, you know, auto or whatever policies. So
I'll move the 74,464, right?
Yes, that's the number. Thank you, Skip. Do I have a second?
A second to that.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. The next one is canine control. That is budget number 292,5400. Now, this is one that we have brought up before, and it is a small change or update. It looks like the budget has been increased by about $500-$600. I actually do not have the, I believe it, you know, because this is an apportionment of numbers that are at a, I guess, district type level. I think it was a change to one of those bigger numbers, and our assessment increased by $566.
Yeah, yep. 1454. I'm reading it right, but
No, that's from last year. I mean, the change from the budget. We voted a budget of 15,398,
right?
And and now we're getting this revised budget of 15,964.
Make a motion. We approve it.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay.
Thank God we can share it.
The next budget is Highway Department salaries, 422,5110.
It's too bad we don't have anybody here who can speak to the budget.
He's right
We do, but I don't know. Well, if we have any questions, I'm sure he'll chime in. To remind everybody, this is one that we held off from voting, and the reason was there was a discrepancy in some of the descriptions, or an inconsistency of some of the job descriptions, and then there was there looked to be some sort of calculation error on one of the hourly rates, even though the salary component was correct. So this budget number is not any different from what we talked about before, to my knowledge.
The titles are set up.
But the titles are set, and the rate for Willer is correct. Before, the salary was right, but the rate was wrong.
Yep.
422-5110.
So this rate is right. 433-736. Is that the correct number, Dylan?
433-735, but
Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions on this one?
I make a motion. We approve it.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Great. Approved. Okay, the next one is Board of Health salary, 511-5400. Mary, how are you holding up on all the numbers over there?
I'm doing it.
The only one that's been different from the packet we have has been the town office expense, so we can always check those. So Board of Health salary, this is one we did take up. Let me just refresh myself. Board of Health. So this was some sort of calculation change by $8. So we had already voted 31,578. We're now being presented with 31,586. Anyone like to make a motion?
Moved.
Thanks.
Second.
Thanks. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. The next one is, or the last one in this series, is interest on maturing debt. That's 751,5900. And the difference here, we had voted this budget before. It is a reduction of $45,000.
Well, that's pretty substantial.
And the reason is previously The bond fees and closing costs for the financing of the school roof project were included in this interest budget, but they are now going to be part of what we bond and just part of the ongoing interest and principal payments over the course of the life of the bond, which I don't know what we always do, but that actually makes more sense to me.
But what's the number that we've got?
The number now is 206,387.
There's roughly 45,000 for the Oxford loan interest.
Right.
And if we're going to end up paying that off this year, we don't need that.
No, it's why not are we going to pay
that?
You
mean the energy loan we're paying off this year?
Oh, that's, I'm sorry,
the energy loan.
Right. Which is why the energy loan is in
there.
Right. Yep, yeah. No worries. So right now, okay. This is just Oxford, the garage, and then the short-term interest for the bands we'll do until there is a longer-term funding at some time in the next year. And the first interest payments would not be till FY18, which is why there isn't a school roof interest payment itself in this.
Mm-hmm.
So again, just to recap, it's just down 45,000 to pushing those closing costs into the financing itself.
They've got 20,000 here for the on the school roof.
Right, for the short-term borrowing interest, right. So that's for the short-term notes, but not for the...
Right.
Yeah. Yep. Any other questions on this one?
Nope.
Anyone care to
make a motion? We approve this.
Thank you, Ralph. Thank you, John. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Is there anything else people would like to discuss briefly before we go into wastewater with Kevin? No? Okay, great.
Do we get new budgets for that or no?
Even better. You're 7 minutes ahead.
There you go.
Perfect.
Do what I can.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Hello, everyone.
So I guess to start would be helpful, Kevin, just to make sure we're all going off the same numbers. The numbers we have for salaries, I have a total of 240,146 for the appropriated amount.
For which wastewater are we in wastewater
yes.
now?
Yes.
I have 243,133.
Okay.
And this comes off of the printing on the bottom right-hand corner was 222,16.
What's your account number?
Is yours the different?
Doesn't have
print
one.
Date?
322.
Okay, then I have to go off of yours then.
Okay.
Can I grab it real quick while everybody else is looking? I'll make a quick photocopy.
Sure, absolutely.
Page 13.
Does anyone else have a different number than 241.46? Are we all, at least on this side, on the same one?
Yeah, I have 240.146.
Right.
That's right.
It's at the very back. It's in the it's after the 900 series
back.
Is where
it
is.
It's towards the back and it
if you go through the 900 series.
I'm sorry, I could have figured out where I pulled it out.
South County EMS
behind
and then wastewater treatment plant.
Unfunded sick leaves. Which doesn't have a number either.
Yeah, these are all warrant articles, that's why they don't have numbers. Sorry guys, that is a little. They're all in the back, though.
Yeah.
They're all in the back.
Yeah, go to the last number and then...
Keep going.
Come back.
And keep going, right. Go to the end and then continue. Awesome.
Come back.
Okay. Has everybody located it?
Nope.
Yep.
You have it, Mary.
Okay.
Right past skim. Must be close.
Yep. Get this one down.
I forgot this one.
Kevin, what do you have for expense while we're doing this?
I got the old one.
For a total.
Total on expense is
$345,965.
Okay,
that I got.
Cool.
Okay.
Yeah, that was getting so ragged, I dead filed it.
And the salaries or the expense?
The salary. Yeah, it's back to back.
All right, Kevin, what do you got for us?
Salaries. I don't know. Which one are you doing first, Kevin?
I'd like to do salaries.
Okay.
Be a lot easier. Get that one just knocked right out of the way. All right. Long story short is we're going up $1,034. It's 0.43%. What that encompasses is a step raise partially for myself. because part of my payroll comes out of wastewater treatment, a step raise for the two operators, and a COLA for the chief operator. Holiday coverages stay the same, emergencies stay the same. Retired employees, that's out of my control. And then it's just the adjustments as they come down through. And then the fringe benefits, which works out to 51,147. The reason why that one is cheaper this year compared to last year is because the latest operator, the bottom operator on your paper there, is a newer employee, so he's being paid a less rate. So that's why there's a difference between the 51,147 and the 55,835.
So one quick question on this one. If I look down where it says operator, first operator.
Yep.
40,152 to 43,493.
It's a step raise. It's part of the compensation package that the town follows. Mm-hmm. It's a single step, not a double step.
I think Skip's but next question is why the next one doesn't change.
Well, we started. No, it's this one. We started, according to this, grade two, step eight. We're going to grade two, step nine. That's an 80-cent raise.
Correct.
$1,600.
It looks to me, Skip, that they
two raises in there?
It looks to me
like not supposed to be. Only a single raise.
It looks to me like they put both raises on the first operator and zero on the second operator, if you guys look at this and the next one.
I noticed that.
I think the total is correct, but I think the breakout of these two is incorrect. Mm-hmm. I think Skip makes a good point.
So the first one is supposed to be step eight or nine?
That's the question, I guess.
9 is 2, 8, 8. Is he eight or nine, Kevin?
All right, so the second operator, grade two, step seven, the number is correct, 40,152.24. And if you take the 20.83 times 2088 is 43,943.004.
943 or 493?
43,493.
Okay. So then.
So let me ask you a question. Do you have the breakdown there?
I have the same exact thing that you have. What I did was I took their hourly rate, the 2083, times.
2088.
Mm-hmm. And I came up with the 43,493.04.
Yeah, no, that's fine. You see where I'm looking for the 2016?
Oh, the 16? Yeah, I don't know.
They don't, something's...
It's not jiving out right, yeah. That's a clerical error.
So, can you take a look at that?
Sure.
But the numbers we're voting tonight are accurate here.
I don't plan to vote this. I was going to vote all these with the rest of the warrant articles. Okay. So that'll also just give us a week to get Doug and Kevin to sort out any of this stuff. So, any other questions or comments on this aside from cleaning up the operator 16 to 17 numbers, which something is going on there?
I assume they're retired employees. Not sure where that comes from. Where'd you get that information? Did you get it from Barbara?
Barbara. These are the numbers that came into play when they were trying to go ahead and try and figure out taxes and fringe benefits, when they were trying to figure out how they were going to be able to have the clerk's office, because technically, if you're utilizing the wastewater treatment plant as a enterprise fund or revolving account, those are the numbers that they were trying to recoup to the town, because in all feasibility, you should really kind of think of the wastewater treatment as a district, because that is only funded by the users. So anybody that's not a user is not funding any of this.
Mm-hmm. So this is an assessment for costs occurred at the town level.
Yep. At the town, that the town is occurring.
Back to the
and has,
district.
I'm assuming, again, I'm not sure, but I'm assuming, I don't know if they were absorbing those costs in the past and they're trying to break it out. We're trying to be more fiscally responsible to make sure whoever's getting services are being charged for those services. Is basically what we're trying to do.
Except for the town.
Actually, that's up and coming. So
I sure hope so.
Yeah, well, I got Town Hall, Senior Center, Library, Elementary School, and Frontier so far. I've got numbers on all three, on all of those.
Oh, you do?
Yep. Basically, what I did was I took the usage for 2016 cycle one.
Yeah.
And I took that, and I took their numbers, divided it by 1,000.
Yeah, this is
times it by 6.74, which gave me my cost of what their bill should be. And when, and then add in $25 for each billing cycle, because that is a service fee. The long and the short is if you want some quick numbers, ballpark.
But the numbers here.
Town Hall would owe $781.90. Senior Center would owe $184.74. The Library would owe $47.92. The Elementary School, $1,934.38. This last number I'm kind of sketchy on because it's such a high number. $23,974.18 for Frontier. That is 3,557,000 gallons of water they used. Obviously, some of that had to have been done on their fields. So my personal opinion is depending on how all this plays out, is I would suggest that anything that they have that is not used inside the building is used on their grounds should be metered separately. So that way they're not being unduly... because otherwise they're going to have to estimate how much water they're utilizing.
So that's what they do now? They have the one meter and they...
That's exactly. And my understanding, once again,
meters.
Was...
One meter
came
reads
up with
the whole thing?
I'm sorry?
They have 2 meters.
I don't know.
One meter reads the whole thing coming in.
Yep.
The second meter goes for the outside fields.
Oh, okay. So that should be... So
we the problem have... is that when they did the mathematics,
yep.
It didn't add up right.
Okay.
And I complained about this, I think, back in 2006.
Okay.
Because they came up with a bill and said that they owed $700 in a water bill. And meanwhile, I was paying $500 for 5 people in a 2-family house.
Sure. That makes sense.
I mean, it was so far off. It was just so ridiculous. And the other selectmen wouldn't listen to me. So I'll bring it up again.
Yeah, certainly. Well, now that I've got a little bit more information. Because like I said, these numbers right here, I just pulled these raw numbers out today.
So Kevin, what was the school? Again,
elementary.
The grammar, yeah.
1,934.38.
Thank you.
That was 287,000 gallons.
So, Kevin, in order to go down this track, right now, you feel that we have all the meters and readings in place, other than potentially the fields. Obviously, maybe there is one, maybe there isn't. But outside of that, verifying that everything else is kind of in place to do this.
The only other thing is going to be different, again, is going to be the town hall, because we do have a watering system out here.
Okay.
So we would have to request from the water department to have them come in and drop in another meter.
Okay. So assuming you got those 2 meters in place, then you'd be able to do it. What do you think is a reasonable time frame? Are you anticipating this is FY18, you know, kind of start talking about it now and FY18 start to try to actually do this, or still unclear?
Well, I mean, it's really still kind of unclear because there's so much information that's going on at this point in time. Besides the set, you know, salaries are set. But when it comes to my operating budget and my actual expenses, mm-hmm. That's kind of a moving target at this point in time because of where we're going to go and what we're going to do. I'm not trying to pull the shade down, but the long and the short is there's a lot of information that still needs to come together, and I'm not going to throw out any numbers whatsoever because I don't want to say come in it, I throw a number off the top of my head at 1 and it's 5,
right.
And then I'm crucified for the next 3 years because I was off by $4 million.
Right.
So I'm not going to do that. Again, we should be having the information hopefully within the next 3 weeks when we have all of our information back from the contractors that have gone out and pulled all this information together.
Okay.
And then head us in the proper direction. This information has to be disseminated to the select board, being the commissioners mm-hmm. of the wastewater, and then they make the decision. So basically, I'm bringing all the information together, and then they make the decision on how they want to proceed.
Okay.
So, and again, I'm not trying to be shady, but there's some stuff I really can't talk about right now because if I do, I'm putting my foot in my mouth.
No, that's, I mean, I think, you know, circling back to what we are here to talk about, which is wastewater salaries and then expenses, you know, I think a lot of these things are going to certainly impact the district and plans for the district and
right.
sewer bills and sewer maintenance and all these other things. But, you know, a lot of those are FY18 or beyond.
Correct.
Does anyone have any more questions specifically to the salary page before we turn to expenses? Okay.
We might mention that we're going to ask for clarification on when you're at the top of your pay grade and then increases on those. Is there a personnel policy? We just aren't sure yet.
Okay.
So we doubt that anyone else is. But.
All right. My general understanding was is we've been using the number of 1.7. They've gone off. What I've been told is we've been going off of what Social Security has basically done in the past. Mm-hmm. You know,
That's not correct.
Do believe that this year, right now,
Social Security got zero.
Zero, yeah.
Presently, right now, my understanding is this year Social Security is giving zero. But the other side of the coin is 4 years ago when Social Security gave 3.875% out. I'm sure the town didn't do that at that point in time.
No, well, there were also no increases for 2 years for Social Security. The third year they got that.
Okay.
So we just need to get that policy clarified so that it can be disseminated.
Sure.
And Kevin, just so you're on, you know, there's two things. There's one is how do you set the number, which you're just speaking to, and we can certainly talk about that as well. And then there's also the question raised earlier was, can we actually set a number? Do the town bylaws, if you actually allow you to go beyond the top grade, you know, can we check and make sure that we're just kind of following all the rules that we need to? And so then if we do have to change something within the classification schedule or the way that the personnel board gets towards these situations, then we need to make sure everything's.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, yeah, the more information we have, the better, the more on target we can be.
Okay.
You know, once again, I'm just going off of what I was told from the select board.
Right.
Office.
Right.
We're going to do an average of 1.7 for budgeting purposes at this point in time anyway.
Right.
So that was the number that we plugged in to try and give you accurate numbers.
Now, yep. Did you get that number out of personnel committee?
Negative. I did not. I got that out of the select board's office.
Because the personnel committee is supposed to make that recommendation to the board of selectmen.
Okay, good.
Well, we have to find out.
There's a bit of chicken and egg, right? Because there's the personnel board setting it, but then also the select board
deciding.
Presenting the budgets.
Right.
So, you know,
I'm meeting to approve it, yeah.
All right. So
when is that, just out of curiosity, when is that information going to be disseminated to the select board office? That way I can start.
Oh, go with what you have.
What information?
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, we've already approved
this is going to change.
Someplace along the way, somebody will say something.
They'll let you know.
I'm sure.
You know, the chicken
zero increase.
Head cut off routine.
All right. Wastewater expense.
Are we going to vote this one or not?
No, we're going to do all the.
We're just going to hold this time.
Yeah, we're going to do all the warrant articles together next week. We just want to have Kevin in because these couple we need.
And
his expertise.
You wanted more information on one of the salaries.
Which
I'll get squared away for you.
So right, yeah, between you and Doug, we'll square away because it may just be an FY16 error and the 17 ones are right on, but either way, we'll get that sorted out.
Exactly. I mean, because that one right there, number two should have been grade two, step eight, and whatever that price was at that point in time.
Right.
And I don't know the numbers off the top of my head.
Right.
So,
I mean, it looks like the 16 numbers are wrong because, you know, if they were different, if they were two steps apart, they shouldn't be getting paid the same amount. And if you look at 16, that's what it says.
Right, exactly.
So,
why would the repair parts go from 20,000 to 40,000?
Right now, we've already spent over 15,000 over and above the 20, and I just got a bill for another $5,000 for a meter. Presently, right now, our existing plant that was built in 1971 is degrading quickly. We have had major expenses this year. We've had major electrical issues between the plant and the controls, where we had to bring in a large team to go ahead and attack this in a short amount of time because we had no power. So at that point in time, we were not treating any water at that point in time, which meant we weren't able to discharge any water at that time, so we were having to hold back. That was a major expense. Again, it's most of the things that are in the plant, once again, there's been some upgrades. I don't want to say absolutely nothing's been done to the plant, but a lot of your hard articles have not been touched. Right now, our clarifier, which is one of the last containers or equipment that it goes through before it goes out for the final
discharge.
There's something else in between. Sterilization, then it goes to discharge. When that motor goes, that's $250,000, which is nowhere even remotely in my expenses. That is more than half of what I have right now for reserve. This plant has been seriously underfunded for multiple years. Take into consideration that the average bill in South Deerfield is about $400. It's approximately 0.6% of the median household income. EPA uses a guideline of 1-2% to be able to fund a utility properly. So we've been 0.4-1.4% under funding this for many years. Think about when we had the pickle factory in there. We had good money coming in at that point in time. Again, it's very easy to be a Monday morning quarterback, but at that point in time when we were making good money, we should have been putting money away. We didn't. So because of we didn't put the money away, we were keeping the taxes down low, which is good, and I understand that, but now it's time to pay the piper. Things are breaking, the thing's falling apart. We have DEP rules that we have to follow, and this is where this plays out. And again, depending on which direction the commissioners would like to go, is going to depend for FY18 where our sewer rates are going to go. Have any of you noticed the
orange?
Yeah. All right. Presently, right now, orange and us are, for the most part, basically the same. For the most part, we have the same infrastructure as far as collection system. They are, bear with me, have a second.
So just so if everyone is heard, there was the article about the town of Orange and the recorder.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I read that this morning there. No. Yeah.
Theirs was built in 1977. Ours was built in 1971. Again, very similar to our size. They're 1.0 MGB, but they only have one. Right now, we're running two plants for less money than what Orange's has budgeted. So kind of take that in perspective. I'm not saying this is how much the rates are going to go up, because once again, I'm not locking myself into anything, but be prepared that, again, depending on the direction that they want to go, on how much they want to fix, and where do we want to look into the future, is going to depend on how much our tax rate is going to go up. And that's about as far as I can go with that at this point in time.
I think Northampton is also facing some pretty steep increases there too.
We are 52% of the national average, or excuse me, the state average of pricing. Mm-hmm. And again, I'm not trying to let the cat out of the bag, but I'm going to let you in a couple more things, again, which was in the same article. USDA, which is one of the people that go ahead and give out grants, mm-hmm. and they do loans, they're not going to give us a loan. They're not going to give us a grant.
Right.
Because we have underfunded this for so long. So it's going to be a deal of, they're going to say, I'm sorry that you weren't prepared, but I'm not going to give you money to bail you out. I'll give you a 40-year loan at low interest, but I'm not going to give you money because we were underfunding for so many years. There is a possibility, again, depending on which direction they're going in, of getting a Mass Works grant. If we get a Mass Works grant, that is going to be the absolute beauty of all beauties, where it should be like 98% grant, zero cost to the users. But again, we don't know until we actually apply. When we were doing the River Road job over there by 116 by the Sunderland Bridge, my understanding is because I came in on the tail end of that project, they applied for that 2 years. It was the third year that they were able to get the grant. So we may not, if we go with Mass Works, you may not see a grant for a couple of 3 years. Again, depends on how you go, depends on what direction you want to go in.
Okay, now with that sort of a backdrop, obviously that things on many fronts are going to be changing in the next 1 to 5 years, both in terms of rates, plans, projects. How do we think about what this budget might look like? You know, obviously we see for next year, for 17, how do you feel about what is this going to be able to do for us? Like, how much is this going to be able to keep up with the state that the facility's in now?
This with no.
Okay.
So can,
with,
what,
I'm sorry.
Let me just ask you.
Yep.
You talked about the repair parts needing an extra 20,000. Then you've explained that one. Sewer line maintenance,
Sewer line maintenance, have you noticed for some reason the year before?
I did notice.
In FY 16, my sewer line maintenance went from FY 15 to $43,000, went down to $24,883. Where did that number come from? I would never ask for $24,883.
That's true.
I would ask for $23,500. I would ask for $24,000. I would not ask for $24,883. I'm attempting to bring myself back up to where I should be, plus a little more, for the simple fact is again, we're having issues at the lift station, okay? Because of the products that are being put into the sewer system, what people are flushing down the toilet is ruining our pumps. Those pumps are not cheap. Okay, we had the pumps repaired, and that was an $8,000 repair.
Thank you for not bringing a bag of that stuff like you did last year. I still remember.
You do?
Yes.
Well, that's good. So the shock factor worked.
Yes.
So there's two pumps in there, all right? So one's already been rebuilt. The other one's going to have to be rebuilt. We ended up having an issue probably 3, 6, 7 weeks ago on a Saturday where we're having issues with the pumping system. I spent 14 hours there on a Saturday trying to get the thing squared away until the point that I finally had to call an electrician, which comes out of Westfield, so I had to wait an additional 2 hours for him to show up to be able to get this thing ratified. Now, if I was not able to fix that at that point in time, the only way that I was going to be able to make that lift station work was to stand there, wait for this number, the magic number, to get to number 33, which is the height, and physically turn the pump on. And as soon as it gets down to 28, physically turn the pump off until it's fixed. So that is what I did basically for those 14 hours, keeping that system running until we were able to go ahead and bring somebody in, fix the system. That was a $3,700 bill.
What was gone on it?
I'm sorry?
What was gone on it?
Basically, it was one of the floats, and it was some of the resistors, or the diode, not the diodes, but the
switch.
It's not actually a switch. Well, it's round, multiple prongs. Sorry, I'm brain cramping right now.
Usually you have a flow switch contactor.
I'm sorry?
Usually you have a flow switch controlling some type of contactor setup.
That is correct. And what the problem was is it was continually calling it for low water. So as long as it was continually calling low water into the system will not run because that overrides the system. So what I was doing is I was overriding. That was the only way I was able to get the septage out of that tank and into the main sewer line was to override because that float switch was bad. I did not personally know whether that was normally open or normally closed. So my question was when I was talking to the guy on the phone, hey, can I just go ahead and cut these two wires? And if it works, then great. And if it doesn't, then I'm just going to wire the two together. And if I don't, am I going to burn something else up? And that's when he's like, I really don't know. Or I really should come down there, whole nine yards. I'm not going to burn up an entire panel over something I'm going to take a guess at. And then so I asked him, I said, well, do me a favor. Bring me a spare float. Bring me some spare relays. And when he showed up with the spare relays, he goes, you can't buy these anymore because of the age of the equipment. Here are some used ones, and hopefully those will work for you. Granted, they gave them to us, but again, the systems are there, have been there a long time, they have not been upgraded, and they're failing.
Kevin, doesn't all of this fit under my broken record of preventative maintenance budget, capital budget? Yeah,
I think this is track two off that record.
Pardon me?
This is track two off that record, I think.
Yeah.
Track two?
off the record, 20. Yeah. What's that?
Track 20.
20.
I mean, it's more highlighted in wastewater, but I mean, you can apply it to any department in town to one degree or another.
Same principle.
Yeah.
So anyway, this budget will help you limp through another calendar year.
That is correct. I should be able to get through this year with this budget right now.
And if I read this correctly, did we not do any lab work in the past? Or?
Well, what they did in the past is they just kind of blended the numbers.
So it came out
different
of thing.
I mean, think about all the things that you really have to charge out when you're looking at the wastewater treatment plant. You know, you're looking at your lab fees. You're looking at your supplies. One of the beakers he ended up buying because of the beaker it has to be, that was $285 per beaker. Okay, so these things that they purchased there are not cheap. It's because they have to follow certain criteria. And with that being said, I'm looking at this because, like, supplies, I'm blowing supplies right out the window. and I need to be able to try and figure out where I can put these things. That's why I've asked for some additional line items,
yep,
so I can break it out so it makes a little bit more sense. Because like you said, in the past, lab fees, we've never, it doesn't show a lab fee, but there is another line item within this budget that has absorbed it, along with many other things that have absorbed in the past.
Okay.
You know, you think about toilet paper. I mean, look at that. Where do I pull toilet paper from? Cleaning supplies, standard stuff, paper towels, administrative stuff. It's, you know, that's where your others come in. You know, and I don't like the word other, because that is not very definitive as to what you're actually spending your money on. The only way to be able to do that is to go ahead, go back, look at everything that's ever been spent underneath that line item and break it down and go ahead and make a spreadsheet. So what I'm trying to do, once again, is I'm trying to be as transparent as possible as putting the things where they actually belong, so that when you look at this, it's easier to understand.
Right.
Is the goal I'm heading towards.
If we had done this 20 years ago, we'd have charged more for our sewer system.
Exactly.
Right.
You know, I mean, unfortunately, you know, we have been underfunded for so many years, and it's coming back to bite us at this point in time.
And, of course, the big danger here is if we do have an accidental spill.
It's $20,000 a day plus repairs. So anything we discharge that does not meet permit is $20,000 a day. 1 ounce or 100 gallons.
Okay.
So.
Can you, I don't recall the shift of the administrative cost breakout that seemed to have started in FY16 and then seems unchanged for FY17?
Once again, these are the numbers that were given to me.
Okay.
That they said that these are the administrative costs that are going to be coming from a combination of the clerk's office and the select board's office.
Gotcha. Okay. And the sludge transfer and disposal, just as it's a large-ish line item, I know we talked about this a little bit last year, how you're doing, you know, numbers of runs with this stuff. Like, how have the last 12 months been from the previous 12?
The spreadsheet I have from, or the expenses from 2015, this can't be right, because it's not showing any appropriations on it. But I can tell you, so far this year, I've gone through 43,000, 44,000, so this may be a little high. But once again, you know, anything that isn't spent goes right back into its own account. So it's not like it's going to a general fund, because this is its own fund. So money comes out, money comes out for it. Yeah. And then anything that doesn't get spent goes right back in the same exact fund, which basically...
It goes into sewer reserve, not into transfer and disposal.
Correct.
Right.
Correct.
Yep.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Everything at the end of the year, except for the few, and I might as well go ahead and bring these up while we're right here.
Okay.
Our capital right now for wastewater treatment, grit removal, $40,000. Great number. Influence solid removal, $50,000. That's great. So we got $90,000 towards this headworks project. Because
so where,
both,
where do I find these figures?
I don't know, summary expenses, expenditures with pending totals.
Is it in a budget someplace? Or?
Under capital.
No.
These are the reports I get from the accountants. And I can make photocopies of these for you if you like.
Not at the moment.
But again, so I got $90,000 going towards a couple things that have to be in this new headworks building. Mm-hmm. That's fantastic. Sewer line rehab. Okay, so if I have a problem somewhere in the sewer line, $3,933.11. If I bring in a contractor, that barely probably covers mobilization fees, depending on where they're coming in from and how big they're going. Capital improvement, $4,574.41. There's no money there.
I think
no capital's ever been put away for this, and right. that's been a huge mistake. And this is once again why we're in the situation we're in.
What they tried to do was save 1 year of operation cost and make that the sewer reserve.
Okay.
And what they tried to do was so that, like for example, one time we had $600,000 and $700,000, and that would fund the operation for the whole year.
Right.
And then whatever we appropriated for that year went into the fund, but it also just backed into the reserve. We always tried to maintain at least a year's worth or more.
As far as the reserve fund, that's right. Great. But there should have been capital.
But the thing is, when they
too.
Did the lineup in Old Deerfield,
right.
That they didn't plan on, they spent $300,000 or $400,000, and then all of a sudden reserve fund went way down to a couple of hundred thousand.
Right.
So now it looks like we've never put anything in there.
That's correct.
In fact, we have been putting money in there, and each year we've talked about increasing it a little bit, but not a lot. Now, this was several years ago when I was on.
Okay. I was going to say, because I'm just trying to...
That's not the current situation. I don't know what it is.
Because I was just trying to figure where these monies were going to be coming from, generated from, to be able to increase these revenues. That was the part. That's why I was looking kind of funny at you.
Well, it looks like some of the figures you got here look like you've got a little bit of slush in there right now, which I don't have a problem with. Because like you say, whatever you don't spend goes into the reserve.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So from that standpoint, I don't like the idea of the thing going up $54,000, but if that's about what it should be, we can't argue with that. We have to accept that as fact. And if we're off by $25,000, so you got an extra $25,000 in reserve. I don't have a problem with that.
I would like to know how that 24883 number ended up in there, because like you said, that is very bizarre. That isn't something that you would request.
I'm very curious about that, too.
If you look at 2014, it was $44,000.
Mm-hmm.
2015, it was $43,000. Mm-hmm. Then you go to 2016, and you go to $24,000.
883. And that sure, doesn't make any sense whatsoever.
Trying to make,
no.
And I agree with you.
No, not a problem.
Make it work somehow.
Yeah.
You know,
I think somebody tried to say, well, let's cut the figure a little bit, so I'll take it all of this one item.
Right. You know, because if you take that increase there and then the 20,000 increase in repair parts, which there's certainly a reason why we're needing more repair parts, that's most of the increase.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So,
exactly.
You know, to me, like, yes, this is a big number, but there are two very big drivers of this, and there are reasons for one and the other. There's a reason for it to be 48,000. What we don't know is how it got to that low number last year.
Right. You know, what I could do, you know, and I'll be honest with you, you know, I've been racking my brain through this, wrapping my head around. I mean, I'm a sewer user, too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so whatever comes up on this, I'm footing the same exact bill that everybody else is footing. So I'm looking, you know, to see where I could, but I'll be honest with you, going through this entire thing, I've gone over it and gone over it, and I've looked at it the last time just before I came up here. The only thing I can do is I can pull $3,000 off the gas, and that's just a guess, because I was assuming the gas was going to be going up.
You're better off leaving it right where it is now.
But other than that, the rest of them are solid numbers, and I really can't move. I mean, I hate utilizing this, but it is what it is. This is what we have to do. These are the costs. This is the cost of doing business.
As you point out, it's not just here. It looks like all the towns are in same pickle.
Certainly. I mean, because like I said, right now in Orange, they're expecting their rates to more than double.
I'll make a motion that we accept the $345,965.
I'd like to not do that just because I'd like to handle all the Warren articles next week.
Okay, fine.
Together, when we just go through.
I'll withdraw it then.
Thank you. I'd like to get a little bit more reasoning behind that 24 number, even though I don't think it has any impact or bearing on my feelings about the 48 for this year. And then, you know, you did mention the heating increase, and not that we're trying to knock 3,000 off of this, but you know, there are some things we've seen across all budgets. Generally, we're seeing reductions in fuel or gas or things just given the backdrop. So maybe that's something that we revisit with you.
Sure. Oh,
we
sure.
can certainly communicate that when we catch up on these other numbers and before we go to voting.
Yeah, certainly. You know, I'd just like to add one quick thing, because I know that it's been mentioned, like you just said, you know, the cost of fuel has gone down. Mm-hmm. Well, that's only going to stay down as long as Saudi Arabia decides that they're going to...
It's already gone back up.
You know? I mean, I know I paid over, you know, if prices are going up. They went up, what, 27 cents in the past 6 weeks?
Yeah.
Total?
Yeah.
Prices are going back up again.
Right, you know? and that's why not, you know, cut... You know, look, this was 11,000 2 years ago in 2014.
Right.
The cost of all energy is drastically lower than that now still, but I also, for the reason you're saying... You can't follow it sharply down because then you're going to have to follow it sharply back up. So I get that.
You know, the other thing is, you know, I could reduce it down and at the end of the year, because of how this is designed, I just have to ask for more money out of reserve to be put into the operating budget.
Right.
So it's just a simple transfer.
Kevin, this heating is strictly building heating?
Correct.
Yeah. Yep. I mean, you don't have to keep waters up to a temperature or something like that.
But some of the buildings have to be at a certain temperature for them to be working properly.
Right.
You know, like for the meters to work, you know, because if they get too cold, the meters aren't working properly, which really means you're not going to be putting in the chlorine at the proper levels. It's chemistry is what that entire wastewater treatment plant is. It's a big
chemistry.
How many
buildings?
Three. And
Kevin, let me ask
South Deerfield and one and a 16th in Old Deerfield. I mean, it's just a little small building, but that one particular building we have to keep warm. The simple fact is that is where we pull our sledge from. Mm-hmm. And in the wintertime, it has to be warm. Otherwise, the valves freeze.
Right.
And we can't take the sledge out, and then we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing.
No. Right.
Do you have this page? I know you can't see it.
What page is that?
Yeah. That's this one. The one we're
talking about. Okay, the one we're talking about.
The one we're talking about.
Yeah.
Do you have that?
Yeah. Yeah, the one that I just copied from you?
So, yeah, for example.
No, it's the expense one that you should already have, and we have the same number.
Okay, yeah.
You've got, for 2016, $80,000 for electricity, $10,000 for heating.
That's correct.
And in your budget, it says $93,000. You don't have that because I just took this from your
guess. So what they did was they just combined the electricity and the heating together, which is where you get the $93,000.
But it should be $90,000 if they just combined it.
If you combine $80,000 and $13,000, that's $93,000.
I don't have $13,000. I've got $10,000.
He's talking about FY16.
I'm sorry.
FY16.
Yeah,
so the question is, are they adding something from lower down that adds to get you another three?
Then I've got repair parts. And I've got equipment repair in here. Maybe it's the same thing.
That's correct. And again, because...
You've got 20, and in your budget it says 10. Then you've got equipment replacement, and I don't see any equipment replacement.
Well, that's probably the other 10 for repair parts.
Well, once again, I'm going off of this.
Could you maybe make a copy of that so that we can follow along?
I'll get a... No, this is...
You know what I mean?
I'm going to give this back. I'm just curious as to where this... Because it's not agreeing with what the town has...
So I think maybe as you're updating some of your line items.
In particular, at the bottom line on this says that your general expenses, $345,312.
That's $965.
And you've got $291,448.
They might have done some creative bookkeeping.
Well, yeah, so it's not matching.
He's
talking about FY16 across the
right,
board.
But just so you're aware, these right here, I don't print these.
Right.
I don't put these together. I drop in numbers, and then these are printed for me.
Okay.
So I think we need to get...
We'll talk with Doug about making sure that those two documents are speaking to each other in an agreement. That's a good point because it does need to be cleaned up. It makes it very difficult to... Look at these changes. And
it makes it difficult. It's got to make it kind of difficult for you to justify the increases when your increases are, if I looked at this as an increase, your increase is $600 over what you have in the budget.
From last year.
From according to that piece of paper you get your hands on. Bottom line, $345,000 supposedly.
Yeah, 345,312.
And the piece of paper you've got over there that's in yellow,
yep,
says 291,000.
We're still talking about 2016.
Yes.
So
yeah.
It's like it's so far off. You know.
So let me ask you this. Never mind. I'm not going to ask. Disregard.
Yeah, don't, because I haven't got an answer.
Well, because I think, and I'm not sure. I mean, how far off are we?
Well, by about $55,000.
Okay. Well, then my thought won't work. Never mind. Because I was just looking at whether they're including in the salaries and the wages.
I haven't. No, those are on the other page. I didn't even bother checking those.
Okay.
Okay, so we need some answers on that. So another good reason to hold off for a week. So we'll follow up with Doug and loop you in as well, Kevin, to make sure we get the FY16 numbers kind of resolved between the town reconciliation reports and the budget that we're being presented with now.
Good.
Does anybody have any other questions for Kevin on this specifically, or does anyone like to talk more about some of the bigger picture items before we move on to a discussion of the capital items?
Big picture items. Going to put some big pictures around here?
You taking up painting or something? You got
sure,
big pictures?
Yeah, really big.
All right, so if we want to move on to capital, John, would you like to come on and join us here at the table.
Kevin,
and Kevin, if you want to stick around, maybe we'll start with a few that kind of relate to things you could speak to as well, and then we'll move on to others.
I'd like to see if I can take a 2-minute break.
Absolutely. And John, if you have a copy of the most updated capital item report, could we make copies of that so we all have the same thing? I'm not sure we all do.
I think I have.
Okay. I hope so.
Yeah.
Okay, that would be great.
I think I'll take that 2-minute break also.
That would be fine.
Thank you.
Let me check.
Thank you.
I'll take two and then you can have one.
For Bill, too. Thanks, John. Thank you.
These lines can throw you off.
This is the same one you sent me yesterday on email, right? Yeah, I didn't have a chance to make a copy, so thank you for
holy crap.
Having a couple.
That's a one.
P-A-R, I think it's B-A-R-A-S-K-Y or something like that.
Okay.
It's close.
Close?
I'm not sure. I'll find it.
You gonna leave us some money for that flush?
Yeah.
So for anybody who doesn't know everyone, John Paresky is the chair of the Capital Improvement Committee. So thank you for joining us and helping us go through these capital item requests. And I guess I'll turn it over to you and just kind of walk us through how you guys looked at this in your committee, and then maybe we'll have some questions as we go.
Okay, this spreadsheet was Doug Finn prepared it, I believe, or he gave it to me. I don't know who makes it.
Yeah, I think Doug put this together.
Do you want to just go down a one item by item, or?
Yeah, sure. I mean, so the first section are the ones that would be funded from general taxation/free cash, right? Those, I think, are going to be the most pertinent to the actual FY17 budget as it filters down. The other have other revenue sources.
It was not the Capital Improvement Planning Committee's decision as to how these were going to be funded.
Okay.
We only approved, recommend,
gotcha.
Yeah, suggest the what should be expended.
Okay.
Doug, Doug or somebody with Doug decided where the money would come from. There's an exception to that, though. The engineering for the Headworks project, the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, when we voted the approval of the $130,000, we did stipulate it should come from sewer reserve.
Okay.
Everything else we didn't, there was no stipulation involved of as to the source of the funds.
Okay.
I guess that's not that. Also, the ambulance would come from the ambulance reserve. Another exception. That. The ones from general taxation, the Ford F-550 with dump body, obviously we approved all these.
Is there any backstory you could give us on the tractor, either one of you guys, just because I know that was on and then maybe wasn't and now back, so what kind of the... In this note here, exactly, deferred to follow.
When we go from here?
Yeah. All
right. Okay, so the tractor.
Right.
Tractor's 25 years old. What I was requested is to go ahead and do some research to find out what it was going to take to go ahead and try and refurbish this thing. I also went ahead and looked into what it was going to be if we were going to have somebody else do our roadside mowing for us. The present price that was given to me was $85 an hour, roadside mowing, 22 weeks, 20 hours a week, 440 hours, times 85 was about $37,400. So that takes like...
So 2 years.
Basically. Yeah, 1.9 years to pay for. Again, if you went ahead and cut that in half, 22 weeks worth of mowing, 10 hours, 220 hours by $85 an hour, $18,700, or it'll take 3.8 years of somebody else doing it that we can go ahead and have our own piece of equipment. Once again, these equipment right here is at least a 20-year lifespan. What we did, again, because I was requested, what would it take to go ahead and refurbish this thing? So to get a ballpark number was hold on a second. Sorry, wrong one.
Where's my total?
$53,130.81.
Okay. Say that again?
$53,130.
What do you get for $53,000?
Short blocks, cylinder heads, gasket, O-rings, injection, fuel lines, shop supplies, waste hazard. Replace and repair implement pump, flush the hydraulic system of all the metal shavings. Fenders, hood, cover, pads, shaft, pads, extension, spring washers, extensions. Replace the hydraulic lines, the bucket, the cylinders, all of the lines. The tires, the rims, the bolts, the front tires, the rims, the okay. center does
okay.
not include.
I think
you missed
point.
The paint.
I think
the only thing it doesn't do is paint it.
Yeah, it doesn't paint it, and it actually doesn't rebuild the front end either.
Yeah, PTO okay. gets you get a new PTO.
You get a refurbished.
Okay,
not new.
It doesn't seem that it would make a lot of sense to spend most of the cost of buying a new one to have a refurbished
one.
I think that's the least attractive option.
So, what is it that you're proposing to buy?
We're proposing to buy a John Deere 5085M utility tractor, 70 PTO horse.
5085?
Yep.
Model.
That's the model.
Okay.
5085M utility tractor. Yeah.
That would be my concern there is... And I don't know whether you discussed, whether the Capital Improvement Committee talked about this, but the comment about deferring to the fall of 2017 from free cash, it's like, I thought that was one of the things that we were trying to avoid doing, was dipping into free cash as soon as it gets certified. And I don't know whether you'd been involved with that discussion, but I think you were. And So this looks like we're going right back to doing kind of things. I didn't think so either.
Casual conversation.
But, yeah.
So, Kevin, is that still the case? Is it still planned to be done that, or is that...
Who makes the decision as to the source of the funds?
Ultimately, the selectmen, yeah.
Well, no, town meeting does.
If you were going
to have to present it to the town meeting
first.
Yeah,
it has to be decided, so somebody's going to make the decision.
If you were going to fund it in that manner, would it be on a warrant article in this town meeting, or would it come up in a special town meeting in the fall, right?
Special town meeting, that's...
So that's my question. Is this planning to be on this warrant or not? And Doug may have the answer to that.
Depends on how you want to fund it.
Not if it's being funded.
It's going to be funded next year. It should wait and go on to an article next year for a special town meeting. It should not be on this one.
So it's...
Then that is a recommendation of the Finance Committee.
Well, and I think to Skip's point, I think that we would, if it's a project that we want to do, we'd rather do it up front and in the budget and at town meeting.
Yeah.
Because I think we're trying to get away from doing things in the fall that aren't unexpected things that come up, you know?
The funding is completely out of my control.
Right, and I get that. I guess one question I'd have for you, Kevin, is... The way that you laid out the cost of hiring it out,
mm-hmm.
and I think that we did it somewhere between in 2 to 4 years was kind of the break even. You were going to spend about $72,000 somewhere between 2 to 4 years, depending on how many hours you hired out.
Correct.
The only question I guess I'd have for you is, would it be worth it to you to do that for a year or two, not for the cost savings of the tractor itself, but so that you could utilize your crew to do other things like tree work? Is that a way to free up man hours, even if it's sort of break even on cost?
Right. Be honest with you, I would just as soon see the tractor now. Once again, simple fact is once you start contracting stuff out, you're at the mercy of when they're going to come and they're going to go.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the one that has to answer the phone when it comes to the people that are calling, finding out why something's not done. This is one person. And since we have gained my old position back, mm-hmm. so at least we're back at full staffing level, it's going to make it a little bit easier. Like I said, this only takes one person. I can ship them out.
Okay.
You know, hey, great. If I could find a part-timer that's got the hydraulic licenses for this, I'd love to be able to do that. Just very simple. I think it was discussed about doing the lawn mowing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but realistically, it's our equipment. I think we need the equipment because this isn't just lawn mowings that this does. You know, it also assists in the snow removal also.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
there was a lot of pushback on capital on this item, and Doug may have done this just to kind of get around that. Deferring thing. I don't think.
And I guess, so what is, away from the funding sources, what is the source of the pushback? Or during some of the initial conversations, what did either you or the committee or whoever wants to speak to it not like about this item versus other things that we're seeing?
We were trying to find a way to cut back on expenditures
and
wanted to investigate that one.
Okay.
What's the threshold for something going into capital improvement planning?
Non-real estate, non-building, our facility is $25,000 or a life of 5 years or more.
So the tractor, the dump body, the tractor, the Ford, that explains that. How about the defibrillators? You got $28,500.
Life of 5 years or more. The present ones, I believe, were like 10, 11 years old.
Yeah.
I don't know what the actual recommended replacement rate is, though.
Yeah, it might be around 5 years.
You know, it could very well be like something similar to like our Scott packs with the fire department. You know, there's upgrades you can do to them. And again, it's not my purview, so I really don't know.
Chief Pachura gave it an estimated life of 10 years.
Okay, there you go.
Perfect.
Yep, he would know.
What's the status on the photocopier for Tilton Library? That's
Tilton Library. Their photocopier is dying.
But that's got a useful life of more than 5 years, and that's why it's on here, even though it doesn't hit the threshold of $25,000?
Correct.
Okay.
All right.
And also, I think there's some things people think of as capital, and they just give it to us. In which case, we took a look at it.
Carolyn was...
I guess the only issue there would be, should it be part of their operating budget?
Right.
For you guys to look at.
I think that's another topic that we
But we do look at it. I mean, it goes through you first, so... I mean, it's...
Yeah, but it's not funded as part of the... Like, the photocopier is not funded with the library budget.
No, I realize
that. Right.
But having another pair of eyes look at it, I mean...
Yeah, it can't hurt, I guess, other than it's in the wrong budget.
Yeah.
Continuing down the engineering for the Headworks project, I think that's self-explanatory.
So, Kevin, can you give us any quick update on where that engineering work stands? And I know you mentioned that there were a couple of small pockets of things set aside for, I think, things that will be built with the Headwork upgrades?
Correct. Once again, it all really kind of all depends on which direction that the select board wants to go with, or excuse me, the select board, which way they want to go with this. Again, this is open-ended on how they want to go, on what the people want, what their foresight is. You know, these are estimated numbers at this point in time.
Do we have enough certainty as to what direction we're going to go that, I guess, the worst-case scenario is we spend money on engineering, and then we decide that we've decided to go a direction that engineering doesn't support, and we've got to do more engineering work to go in a different direction. Well, is there still enough flexibility at the point in time where we're at now that not having made a long-term decision, this work will still be usable regardless of what
choice you make? Correct. That is correct. If anything, it would go up.
If anything, what would go up?
The engineering fees.
Depending. But I just want to make sure we're not going to have to do work again because we haven't decided yet what we want to do down the road.
No.
The way we understood it. This is a standalone.
Well, but what upgrades you do in the Headworks facility might be impacted by what your end game is from a facility level.
That
right?
is correct. Yeah. That is correct. Because, once again, you know, it's... Never mind. No, I'm not going there.
Fair enough.
One of the things,
again, whatever's
decided up in Old Deerfield, whether it comes to South Deerfield or whatever,
correct.
The Headworks project that you're planning now
will handle
with 130
okay.
will
correct.
Handle whatever situation,
correct.
Whether it's two separate or two together or whatever
correct.
The case may be.
Okay.
So it's not going to be a wasted dollar.
That
amount.
Is correct. And okay. it's also going to be engineered because we need to look at the future. Right now, and I'm going to mess these up, there's two tests two chemicals that they're looking at, and if I look a little bit, I can tell you exactly what they are, but off the top of my head, I can't tell you. Right now, we're not required to do it. Are we going to be required to do it in the next 5 to 7 years?
Remove them from discharge.
Remove them from discharge. Sure. So within the next 5 to 7 years, will we be? Once again, all depends on how the state wants to push.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing with the MS4 requirements. You know, I believe that's phosphorus and something else that has to be removed. Those components themselves would not be inside the new Headworks building, but the building would be designed to accept them.
Okay. And are those all things that we look literally down the river and see? Connecticut is already starting to do them, and that's kind of where
right now they're hammering the big people. They're hammering Springfield. They're hammering Holyoke.
Right.
You know, they haven't made it up the river yet, but like and hopefully I'm not messing this up, but it's like the phosphorus. You can only control so much of that because you've got so much farmland that is close to the river.
Right.
So how much is in, and I'm not trying to throw mm-hmm. darts, I'm just making a statement.
Mm-hmm.
How much is coming from them? How much is coming from us? How much the combined going down affects whatever the phosphorus affects in the aquatic life or the water quality? Because once again, I'm not a chemist, so I don't, or at what point do they say, we need to tighten this down more, so now they're going to come, and who are they going to be able to do? Is they going to be able to come to the town because they can control us?
Mm-hmm.
they can't control farming because they've got the right to farm. Mm-hmm. So they're hitting the big boys now. They're going to start hitting the little people. And then we're at the end, and then they'll be at the end because they won't be able to go any further.
Gotcha.
So these are things that are going to be coming down the road. They know, once again, because it's happening down in Connecticut, and it's slowly making its way literally up the river. I just want to be prepared.
Right.
You know, if we build something, like you said, I don't want to go ahead and build something and go, oh, man, and then have to spend another $20,000 and dig out a sump inside of a building that's brand new.
Yeah.
You know, let's think with our heads instead of the blinders is what I'm trying to do. And again, these are all options that come up to play with the commissioners, which direction you want to go.
Okay. The and one of the concerns that I have is not with the project, but how we get to this project. We go out and we hire an engineering firm to take a look at our plant to tell us what's wrong with it, and then we hire the same engineering plant to design.
Well, I think we've already discussed this at one point in time.
Basically, is we've got, you know, there's an incentive for the engineering firm to find something wrong so that they can fix it.
Oh, certainly.
And is there some way that we can avoid that we could get a second opinion?
Sure. I mean, I can go out and spend more money and have somebody else come in and look at the same exact thing and duplicate our services. Basically, what we've done is we've gone with Weston and Sampson. Weston and Sampson has been extremely good to this town. They have given up multiple free engineering to the town in the past. The engineering that was done, and again, I'm not throwing stones at other companies, but there was other companies that the town used in the past, which were not in the best interest of the town, did not give the best service to the town, did not produce the proper product to the town. So Weston and Sampson, once again, upstanding engineering firm. We've had no issues with them. We've got a good working relationship with them. If finance would like to go ahead and fund somebody else to come in and look at this entire thing, I'd be more than welcome to that. I would share my books, everything that I have, with whoever wants to come in and look. But once again, myself and the commissioners do feel comfortable with Weston and Sampson at this point in time because they have been an outstanding vendor for us.
And that, you know, on top of that, I think there's a clear demonstrated need to revisit the town's long-term plans for the wastewater treatment plants at both Old and South Deerfield. It's not like we're not sure if it's time to have this conversation. I think everybody's pretty sure that something needs to be done. This number here, the 130, has that changed much since we started? I can't recall in the meeting we had a while ago. And, you know, do you feel it's a pretty good number?
Right at this present time right now, it's a pretty good number.
Okay.
There's a couple of things that might tweak up again. And again, it all depends on the direction. The direction of where they want to go is really going to depend on where these numbers move around.
Okay.
Which inadvertently will affect the rate.
So the headworks project is the first thing that needs to be done with the sewage treatment plant.
That is correct. That is the start.
What have we got for a rough estimate of total cost for the headworks project?
I'm not telling.
1.3.
There was a...
Well, we'll go with 1.3, but again, I'm not throwing out any numbers. Again, because...
Scope needs to be defined.
Right. Things have changed inside of the headworks building themselves, depending on, again, which direction we want to go to. And again, I'm not going to open the book on this because I can give you some thoughts to think about. Would the ratepayers be willing to accept septage into our plant? So in other words, somebody goes ahead and pumps their septic tank, would we be willing to accept that? Presently, right now, we don't, because we can't handle it, because it's not handled properly. If you want to go ahead and add that into it, ballpark guess, $80,000, $70,000.
That's your earnings.
No, that's more you're going to have to spend to make that work.
Oh,
now, realistically, if you pulled in
10,500 gallons of septage a year at, what is it, 0.0725 cents a gallon works out to something to the effect of like $41,000. So if you were to go ahead and decide to take septage, feasibly, it should pay for itself within 2 years. But is that something you want to do? Again, that's not my purview. I'm here to lay out all of the options, and then they figure out which direction they want to go in.
We used to accept septage until the stuff broke down, and they said it was too much trouble to take care of it, so they stopped doing it. They stopped accepting it.
Right.
Yeah, Kevin makes a good point that, you know, a lot of decisions are going to need to be made, and it seems to me, and I don't have all the details, and maybe you don't either, but
I don't either.
We're going to have, from a timeline perspective, in somewhere around 12 months, perhaps for the FY18 budget, and we're sitting down to do this next year, we're going to have a much more concrete picture of what this Headworks project is going to be, and what we're going to need at that point in time to have a better idea of what we're trying to build towards. These questions that we're talking about now are going to have to be answered primarily by
right.
the sewer commissioners and in conjunction with you and Weston and Sampson. But, you know, these are really big decisions that need to get made in terms of the scope of this project, because, you know, next year we're not going to be able to say we'll figure it out in 12 months. We're going to need to know, because we're going to need to be starting to do the headworks, starting to plan for the bigger project, whatever that's going to be, and start thinking about how we're going to fund that and the timing of that project.
It sounds like there's enough questions on the plate as far as where the EPA and such are going in the future on what they're going to accept, that maybe we don't want to jump ahead of it too much.
Well, that's a very fair point.
Yeah, but like I said, we're just going to go off the phosphorus and the other thing. We're not buying the equipment to do it. We're just making sure the space is there to put it in.
Right.
So you're looking at 400 square feet.
Right.
Ballpark. So.
And look, the reality is that no matter when you try to build it, it's going to, as soon as you drive it off the lot, you know, there's going to be something that
right.
they come up with
bigger,
the next
better.
Day that right. you haven't planned for. So, you know, if you wait for that, you wait forever to some extent.
You got to start sometime.
Right.
So
I'll bring you an article. There is a project going on. The EPA has gotten 23 communities around the country where they're doing accelerated composting.
Mm-hmm.
And it cuts the cost pretty substantially of the product.
Of...
They're composting wood chips and sludge and.
Oh yeah! Oh yeah. Certainly! Yeah, I mean
when the
know, once again, it all depends on what you want to do. You know, the sludge hauling. You know, and I'm just going to throw some real stuff out real fast. Mm-hmm. We want to go ahead and buy a tractor trailer, the dump trailer. We can go ahead and we can take our sludge and we can bring it up to Great Barrington, and they'll take it up there. At
no,
a cheaper
cost. No, I'm not
cost.
Suggesting that.
But what I'm getting at is there's so many things that are out there. That is the possibilities.
Right.
You know, and these are all things that we're trying to put together in one packet and explain it once.
Right.
And, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so, what I'm suggesting is they've got at least a couple of experiments going on that they may come and say, these are acceptable ways of handling it in the future.
Oh, certainly.
Want. And that one is being used.
For the sludge, correct,
years.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, because, well, the great thing that was, the first great thing was the belt press. We've got a belt press.
Mm-hmm.
Hasn't run in 17 years, and we can't sell it. The technology's too old. Nobody wants it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's realistically, it's scrap metal sitting inside the building. You know, it worked for a while, then it didn't work. And again, because, like you said, things change. And you know, I'd love to have the crystal ball, because if I could have the crystal ball, boy, I'd be making the hedge bets and pointing money in the right places, and I could retire earlier. But
well, it must have been,
I can guess at,
20 years ago anyway. The university actually took a lot of our sludge and spread it on fields.
Yeah, they used to put it on.
The heavy metals showed up from cleaning.
Yeah, exactly. Copper was the big thing that we were having issues with.
Yeah.
Here in town, our sludge was
right.
copper issue.
Yeah.
Does anybody have any more questions specific to engineering headworks?
I do. For the $130,000, what are we going to get?
That's up and coming. I'm not going to sit here and I'm not going to try and re-explain the entire rate study. All of the things that have come into play. I should be able to give you these numbers, hard numbers, hopefully within the next 2 weeks is what my plan is. All of these numbers are supposed to be coming back into me.
Maybe I'm misunderstanding. Is your question, Skip, not what plans will there be, but what will, like, are we going to be getting completing construction-ready plans of whatever we end up doing? Like, what is the, what's at the goal? End of the 130,000, what do we have?
At the end of the 100, at the, basically you would have some shovel-ready for the headworks.
Okay.
Period.
So was that your question?
Yeah, and we're going to do the headworks.
I certainly hope so.
We need to.
We have to.
Well, that's...
We can just continue to limp along, and then... I mean, you could, realistically, and I'm not trying to sound like a smart aleck, you can do absolutely nothing. Not spend any money. But whatever monies you don't spend today, add 6% next year. Add 6% the year after that.
But my point is, at town meeting, which is essentially a month away...
Right.
The question is going to come up. Why are we spending $130,000?
And at that point in time, I will be able to give you all of that information because everything will be in print. I plan on, my plan is anything that's got to do with me, as far as wastewater is concerned, there's going to be a handout. And then that way everybody can look at it. So it's not a he said, she said, well, this is what I heard on TV. Well, this is what I heard at Jerry's place. This is printed material that everyone will get the same exact information at the same exact time. You know what I'm saying?
Do you know if that will be ready for April 12th, I believe, is the pre-town meeting?
I'm hoping to have this
meeting
done within 2 weeks.
Okay.
Is what I'm told.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, I mean.
All of these are coming out of the wastewater reserves.
But I'm still not willing to say yes to this until I know all of the stuff that goes with it. That's all.
All right. That's fine.
The conversation has to be really get that rate study done, and then there has to be a conversation with the town. How do we mend the two sides together?
Well, I mean, to be fair, we did have a pretty extensive presentation a while ago now from Weston and Sampson about the Headworks project, and I do understand Kevin's point that some of these things are moving targets based upon the ultimate plans of what direction the town wants to go. But, you know, we're not, at least I don't feel like I'm coming in flying blind. I certainly am looking forward to getting more details as we get them together, as we have more answers of what direction we're heading. But, you know, I do think that there's been, I guess, as a side note, I'd say I think you've given very good communication about this project over the past, not days, but months or quarters.
No, almost going on 2 years.
Yeah.
But if we're going to have more information in 2 weeks, I just assume wait for 2 weeks to...
Right. And like I said, I was hoping to have this done earlier, but once again, the rate study was put off for a while before we actually approved the money to be able to do it, which inadvertently just put me behind the eight ball.
Mm-hmm. Back on the dump, on the F-550, what is going? I assume that's a replacement.
That is a replacement for a 2006 F-350. The reason why we're going from an an F-350 to an F-550 is basically it fits our needs better. The truck has been continually overloaded. Excuse me, when we go out, we plow and we sand. If anybody has ever noticed that truck when it's going out, as soon as we're loaded, because of the route that it has to be able to try and cover, is extremely overloaded. The front end is sticking up in the air. We're putting on too much, but if we don't put on as much as we do, they're not able to make the coverage of where we're trying to get to. We've attempted to go ahead and look at all the different things. We've looked at trying to change routes. We've tried to move a bunch of other things. This is just not a snap decision. One, two, we were asked for a replacement schedule, and this is part of our replacement schedule. We've had multiple issues again because of the overloading. Literally, we've been having the wheel studs pop directly off. We've installed the helper springs to help it keep them from dragging going down the road. And we're having a transmission issue. When you put it in reverse, it shudders like hell. You got to wait for a second and then go ahead and hit the accelerator. Do I want to go ahead and spend $6,000 on another transmission? No, I certainly don't. You know, it's time to replace this. It's part of the schedule. Yes, I am going from a 350 to a 550, but the 550 is better suited for the needs of the highway department, which
it's essentially a small dump truck.
Yeah, exactly.
And the 350 is a pickup truck, a large one, but it's a
pretty much with a dump body on it.
Maybe it wasn't such a good idea. So are we going to replace the F-350 at some point as a pickup truck, or?
No, the existing one that we have now is a 2006 F-350 dump truck.
Yep.
That is going. And this would be its replacement. And hopefully, because it's age and because of the mileage, there is a possibility we can be getting as much as, well, again, these are older numbers, $10,000, but that was back in 12 of 2014 is when I got those numbers.
How does that compare with the dump trucks that we have now, that we put plows on?
The latest one we purchased was $156,000.
Okay.
Which is one of the new Freightliners. Ballpark. I could be off $5,000 here.
That's what I was asking, is how they compare in price.
Sure.
And size-wise, is the Freightliner that much bigger?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, sir.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
How are the Freightliners doing?
Great.
Good.
Great. We'll go with that.
Okay.
we've had some issues with them, but fortunately they've been covered underneath warranty because we bought new.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we went ahead and we bought something that was used, everything that we've done so far, we would have had to have eaten.
Yeah.
Could we use one of those in place of this F-550 that you're talking about buying? Or is that just overkill?
Oh, that's major overkill.
Okay.
I appreciate the idea of trying to get something bigger, better, but this suits our need, because there's a lot of times there's some smaller jobs that we need. We need just the one ton or the 550. We're able to get into places easier because those are four-wheel drive.
Mm-hmm.
Take real good one to think about is Hawks Road. Okay, Hawks Road is still technically a town road. We have to maintain that road. Okay, unless you have a four-wheel drive, you're not getting through that road. Technically, the road is still closed because of the season. But this road is going to have to be fixed. And to be able to fix it without completely redoing the entire thing, I can get in there with a one-ton four-wheel drive, and I can start doing some repairs. If I try and go ahead and get in there with the bigger truck, then I'm going to have to spend a whole boatload more money to go ahead and get the road better before I put the truck on it, because I'm not going to lose a truck on the road. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So there is advantages to having the smaller truck.
Anything else on either the general taxation or sewer reserve sections that we've been covering so far before moving on to municipal building reserve?
It's your turn.
Kevin put in a request to replace the Ford F-250 that's up at the old sewer plant with a F-350, I believe.
Yep.
And our committee felt it wasn't necessary. So we did not approve that. And Kevin since has withdrawn his request. That's why that line item is on there.
So it's kind of a double-edged sword for me, to be honest with you. I don't grab it this year. I don't know what I'm going to. You know what? I'm going to take a roll of dice. It's a 2003. It's definitely more than due to be replaced, but because of the cost that we're incurring already within the treatment plant, it is what it is. We're just going to have to suck it up. You know, but like I said, should I, if I was thinking financially with my head, as far as a strictly a department head, I should be moving forward with this, whether it was recommended or not. But again, I'm trying to think at the big picture. That 42 grand could come into play somewhere else down the road, and I'm trying to be as fiscally responsible as possible. So that's why we pulled it.
Okay.
You know, and again, because at least my department was requested for a 5-year plan. So basically what we did was we went ahead and we put together a 20-year plan. So for the next 19 years, you'll know if you go by the schedule of how much you're gonna be spending each year on equipment. Again, that was fairly easy to do because if you go on the premise,
that has already been set was pickup trucks and cars and things like that, 10 years. When you get into the heavier equipment, depending on what it is, 20 to 25 years. Again, some of the implements that goes along with some of the equipment, it depends on how long, you know, how often you use it. Very similar, the sewer router machine, okay? The sewer router machine is early 60s, okay? And that's easy for me to do the math because it's basically 40 plus years old.
John probably voted to buy that one, so maybe that's...
So the long and short, I mean, does it work all right for us? Yeah, you know, have we had issues with it? Yeah. Has it failed when we needed it? Yeah. Has Chuck, our mechanic, been a whiz in being able to make chicken soup out of chicken poop? Certainly, he has. I mean, I cannot
just
say enough about...
Just don't invite me to dinner, right?
The bottom line, the kid is amazing, you know, and he has definitely saved the money, saved the town huge money on being able to resurrect things. You know, one of the things that he and I were talking about very specifically about that is, you know, let's see if we can do an upgrade to the transmission. You know, because the transmission in that thing, it's literally, it's a transmission with a stick shifter hanging out of it. You know, and then you've got two controls that you move it this way and you move it that way, and it tells the sewer rod to go in or out or whether it turns or doesn't turn. Again, 60s era technology. Can we make it work? Yeah. For the amount of times we use it, certainly. You know, for the cost of a new one, huge money. Realistically, you know, most people don't go ahead and buy a sewer router machine. Most everyone goes ahead and goes out and buys a Vactor truck at this point in time. Vactor trucks are extremely expensive, anywhere between $400,000 and $500,000. The expense of the upkeep of them are extremely expensive. So can we go ahead and backtrack, going back to the antique piece of equipment that we have, the Chuck Skills? Can we make this thing work for another $6,000 or $8,000? Yeah, we probably can.
Well, we certainly appreciate your thought going into these plans going forward. You know, the one you put together for the highway department and your thought going into the sewer or the wastewater treatment plant, we really do appreciate that because it's not easy. And like you said, the easy thing to do is just to go after as much machinery and equipment as you can every year and hope you get as much of it through as you do. So we appreciate having that schedule so we can start to know what's coming.
In that vein, the Capital Improvement Planning Committee excuse me, will be working on a five-year plan where our first meeting will be May 25th.
Okay.
So I know there's been a lot of talk that we need it, and we're going to start working on it.
Great.
See what happens.
Okay. How about these items in the that will all be, it seems, coming from the Municipal Building Fund?
He's asking now.
That was, again, where the money came from was not my decision. The carpet over the Tilton Library was put in 1997. It's pretty beat up, and obviously, I mean, if you look at it, it needs to be replaced, and they're going to use carpet tiles, or what was the exact language?
Yeah, the carpet tiles are the ones that are the selling point.
Basically, put in there.
Apparently, is that carpet you need tiles. To replace them, you can go pull them up and put new ones down.
Right. Exactly. Somebody makes a stain, somebody makes an issue, or if you've got an area that's a high usage area, people keep going out, in and out, wear it down, pull them out, pop down new ones, and you still got a brand new carpet because it matches the stuff that's underneath the radiator or something like that.
How long are those available? So 10 years from now, are you going
to
be able to
realistically get them? I mean, you need to, once again, you have need to have enough forethought when you buy. Yep. You really should buy now and have what they call attic sock.
Yeah,
so that way it's all part of the same time frame as when you actually
same
bought
room.
It. So, I mean, realistically, you know, if you're doing anything with those tiles, carpet tiles, hypothetically, you've got 10 boxes, okay? Well, you don't just take the first box and use all of that one, the second box and use all of that one. You take a little bit out of each one. So that way, when you're done, because the one run may be different from the other, unless you can guarantee the carpets that you're getting within those squares are the exact same run, the exact same dye, the exact same day, the exact same crew.
Because otherwise, realistically, can it alter a little bit from one shift to another? Certainly. Again, that's why, personally, myself, what I would do is I would go ahead and I would get multiple boxes, put down what you need, and then that way your quote-unquote attic stock or something extra will be an actual blend of all of those, which hopefully should blend in better if you do have to replace it. I should say when.
I can remember doing this at the school, and I don't know whether they bought extra or not. Mm-hmm. How it's worked?
At the elementary school?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's upstairs, second floor. Okay. I've seen it.
The
2 weeks ago.
The cost, if I remember correctly, was about 50% more than the cost of regular carpeting. Mm-hmm. And it wears about the same as regular carpeting, give or take.
Okay.
My experience with regular carpeting is that if you have a spot that's worn out, if you have a piece of carpeting that's the same as the original, you can cut that out and put it in. It's a lot cheaper to do that than it is to try to do the carpet.
Squares.
Well, I don't want to go against what you're saying, but I can tell you that that office in there, when we priced out regular carpeting in the squares were cheaper.
Okay.
And that is why we went with the squares in there.
If the squares are cheaper, I don't have a problem.
That's what was there.
But we did it at the school. It seemed to me it was give or take about 50% more for the squares.
And it could be that was
20 years ago. No, it was 10 years ago.
10 years ago?
Yeah, probably.
I'm not sure what the technology was.
2005, something like that.
Why are they proposing to change the air conditioning to mini splits?
It's the current system is old and noisy. They have two air conditioners outside. They're inefficient, they're noisy. So they wanted to get mini splits so they could also use the heat aspect of them in the winter. And
so they want to use a heat pump feature.
Yeah.
That is correct.
Right. Yep.
So, now, how have you compared the efficiency? Because a lot of times they tell you it'll be more efficient, but they're the same efficiency.
Efficiency compared to what?
They have an EER rating on each piece of electrical equipment. Have you checked to see what the efficiency was on the current units versus the new ones they're proposing?
No.
No.
What's their heating? What do they use for heating over there now?
Oil.
Oil?
Oil. And she budgets 1,500 gallons a year.
Is it oil steam?
Yes. How, out of curiosity, how old is that heating system?
Actually, that heating system is fairly new.
Yeah.
I want to say probably in the past
5 years or so?
Yeah, my guess was seven, but yeah, it could have been five.
Why are we still using oil when there's gas out on the street?
That I couldn't tell you. I wasn't.
It's too late now for that. But
right.
Don't know. Can't get it now.
That's it. But we could have 5 years ago.
Kevin, from a facility standpoint, to the extent that you can answer this question, do you feel that this replacement is something that'd be nice to have or something that we need to have?
I think it's definitely something we need to have. I mean, Bill was in there. Was it last summer when the ACs weren't working properly?
It's like a pot house in there.
Okay.
That old building.
For the most part, the windows aren't open because everything's been painted shut. Mm-hmm. I personally, myself, as far as a comfort level, it should be replaced.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then on both of these, this and the carpet, is there any concern that these will be poor investments if you consider some future larger projects that the library might do, you know, similar to other things we've talked about? I'd hate to go in a direction and then
we discussed that. We were aware that this is possibly something major is going to happen with the library,
right?
And we were told it wasn't going to happen for at least 10 or 12 years, so
and the
a long time out,
really.
I forget who said that. Is that wrong?
No, I thought there was something much sooner.
Well, they were under a couple million bucks, and it's not going to be there for them. So I think maybe they've gotten smart to that. And they were going for a grant. But the superintendents, the rural superintendents group that's formed, one of the pushes they're hoping to do is to let the schools back off of that clawback if you use that some of their space for something else, like library facility or something. You have to pay back the state funding of the school.
Yeah.
And if they could get that changed, all these rural elementary schools have a lot of space. So that might come down the pipeline.
Meaning
I didn't know there was a provision where you got to pay back.
I thought once a school is paid for, it's paid for. Once it's paid for, it's paid for.
There's nothing to... So and you can repurpose a school if you
yes.
want.
Okay. Yeah, it's the ones that are still paying on the... There's a debt service on it, and there isn't on the school.
So to answer your question, on the library, on the HVAC, the heat pumps, yeah, definitely. The carpet, I mean, I'm quite sure they're not going to reuse carpet, but if they do something, they can obviously reuse the heat pumps.
Okay.
We can reuse the heat pumps somewhere else here in Town Hall.
That's true, too.
I mean, we can go ahead and pop those out and put these in here and deal with the multiple issues that this building itself has.
Sure. How many air conditioning units do they have?
Right now, two.
Two.
They're outside.
Ground mount?
Correct.
Yeah. Okay, so there it's...
That means they have central air conditioning now.
Correct.
Central air conditioning.
Central AC only. This would be central heat and AC, which should hopefully take some of our carbon footprint away from the usage of oil for heating. How's that?
Yeah, but that was usually you're burning
snack for the day.
It's a green
you're burning
point.
Oil to generate the electricity.
Oh, they're going to make that anyway, so. Electricity always has to be made. It just keeps moving around and around and around until somebody uses it.
All right.
Realistically?
Any more questions on the two library items or comments?
I do have one concern. Not a concern. Something that the Sandry did the proposal. This is based on Sandry's number, and they said that it's recommended each outdoor unit have a roof mounted over it to minimize the opportunity for snow and ice falling on the units. I hope somebody will take the ball and make sure that happens.
Yeah, we discussed this collectively, you and I, at that meeting. One of the issues that I know that Sarah had with the units, how they were protected in the past, they were too tight, they weren't maintained properly, they had lattice work, the vines got in there, which inadvertently got in and started getting into the AC units themselves. Since then, the last time we had the work done on it, we removed these completely. Nothing has fallen on these units, for one. For two, you know those little lean-tos you put over your trees for Christmas time? Or I'm sorry, for winter time? We can do the same exact thing. As far as a permanent structure that goes over the top of this, okay. You know, one of the pieces of slate can come off and cut one of the lines on its way down. There's just so many different things that can happen. But the long and the short is, yes, we collectively would make sure there was some type of protection over the top of it.
Okay.
And we put them on the end of the building where the...
Again, location
the
is...
Roof
that,
is
would, that would make
like
the
this.
Most sense because that's where the first one was put.
Yeah.
And again, these numbers right here from February 2005, historically numbers are only good for 30 days.
You mean 2000?
Again, depending on how long it's going to take to be able to go ahead.
You mean 2015, right?
Not 2005.
You said 2005. I'm sorry. Yeah, February 5th, 2016. What did I say, 2012?
You said 2005.
2005.
Oh. Sorry. Been a long
Very stale.
It's been a long day.
Sure.
February 5th, 2016 is when it was done.
Okay.
Usually they're only good for like 30 days. And realistically, because of the cost of this, right now we only have two bids. So by standard procurement municipal laws, we have to go out, resubmit it again. Mm-hmm. And we'd have to get at least three or at least request three. However many we get back is however many get back, and we can again continue to follow the procurement rules and regulations.
Okay.
How do you plan on upgrading the fire detection system?
That to us was for $2,500 was kind of a no-brainer. Right now, all it does is if there's a fire or somebody gets
fire or pull station
on access and they shouldn't, there's a little light flashes outside.
And that's
it. Upgrade it so it'll talk to like an ADP security system. I don't know who they're going to use. To us, we felt it was worth it. There is a caveat in our approval that the finance committee approved the operating costs of that third party.
Of the what, I'm sorry?
Of the system. Pardon?
Approve the operating costs of
the ADP or whoever they use.
The operating costs. Once the equipment has already been put in and the system is up and running,
okay,
then the yearly monitoring fee.
Yeah, the monthly or yearly monitoring.
Right. It's $900 a year for the town hall side is $600. Sorry. Let me back up. Each of them $30 a month, so $60 a month monitoring fees is what there is.
Do you know that telephone, emergency phone you have outside?
It's not going to be a telephone. We have to go with a radio. Basically, what we're going to do is we're going to go with an AES Intella fire alarm radio transmitter antenna and full data transfer module. This does follow NFPA and Massachusetts rules and regulations. As far as fire service is concerned, what it does is the radio bounces off of Toby. Toby in turn goes ahead and signals directly into their dispatch area, which is in Agawam. They in turn go ahead and call out. The people that we're talking to right now are Citizen. Citizen is a very well respected company. Multiple businesses here in town presently have them right now. Being on the fire department, I recognize the fact of which systems are good and which systems are not good, which people are good and which people are not good when it comes to trying to get repairs, trying to get emergency services out of them. Citizens seem to be the best of what we could get. And pricing-wise, they're all pretty much ballpark the same price.
So, is it in the budget?
I'm sorry?
Is the $720 in the budget?
That would be in town hall budget, not mine.
So I do remember
that was my understanding
is
it was supposed to be added into. But again, a lot of these things all depend on whether they're going to come into play or not. You know,
chicken and the eggs.
There's no way of going straight to the dispatch, so the dispatch will dispatch the fire department.
No. Well, yeah, you can if I want to spend more money. I'm trying to do this as cheaply, as most effectively as possible.
How much more money is more money? Ballpark.
Ballpark, probably about $1,200-$1,400. That is for the communication part, which is because right now, these right now don't have dialers. Mm-hmm. And if you go into a dialer, like Jack was saying, now you have to have a dedicated line. So now we're going to have to pull another dedicated line, copper line, because Massachusetts does not recognize Comcast wireless, they don't recognize cable at this point in time. The state does not. So, like when we got the fire alarm system for the highway department, mm-hmm. we have a dedicated line only for that. Nobody can use that line. You can't even dial out on that line.
That's a telephone line.
That is a telephone line, and that is what you have to have. Or you can go the less expensive way, which is the way I'm trying to go towards, and go with a radio system. So not only do you have the original setup of having to change out the equipment inside here to make it a dialer, then you have to bring a phone line to it, and then you have to maintain this dedicated phone line as long as the building is in place, or they decide to change the rules.
Yes, we do it at the highway garage. There's no reason not to do it here. That would be my first inclination.
Because right now, like you said, you know, if we have an issue here, strobe light flashes outside and their horn goes off. And hopefully somebody will come by and look at it.
The hell do you suppose that is? Huh? Yeah.
You know, and realistically, you know, we're part of
the town building has to be upgraded to the point of being able to pass its inspection is probably the easiest way of stating it. A lot of the equipment that's in here is extremely old. I'm just quite sure the smoke detectors and the heat detectors within here are original to when they rehabbed the building. Fortunately, because it's commercial, it does kind of come into a little different play, because historically, when you're talking smoke detectors, CO detectors for your home, there's a certain expended life, and then they say replace them. There is possibility, so long as the system passes its inspections, it is still a viable system. So it could be 50 years old, and as long as it does what it's supposed to do and passes its inspection, then it's good. But again, the last time these were inspected, I honestly cannot tell you. I know they haven't been inspected in the past 6 years, because that's how long I've been around.
So we don't know whether they work or not.
Correct. So there is an inspection that has to happen every single year, and they go through, they test all of the smoke detectors, they test all of the heat detectors. When they go over the other side, they have to test the sprinkler system, making sure everything there is proper too. Because if you have equipment in the building and it's there, it has to be inspected.
One thing about...
So you have to get it inspected down at the highway garage.
That is correct.
One thing about installing these systems is, you know, a lot of the different features of things we'll be using already, strobe lights and horns and smoke detectors, obviously a lot of those are going to need to be replaced, I would imagine, and that can get a little bit pricey. You know, the annual fees for these services are fairly reasonable, but the replacement and maintenance, which you do want to do, is kind of where it gets pricey. So that's the one thing, and I know you will keep an eye on, because we're going to have to do it.
Well, I was going to say, if we put any sort of alarm system in, aren't we going to have to test out all of those features? No matter what kind of an alarm system, no matter what we've got,
let me put this way: what you presently have right now, whether it calls out or not, we have to spend ballpark $1,000 a year, roughly,
right,
between this side and the police department side. It's $600 for this side, it's $300 ballpark for the police department side for the inspections, and it's because of the different, how many different units there are in the different side. Obviously, there's many more units on this side than there is on the police department side.
I guess what I'm saying is that, you know, if the price, if there's a reasonable payback, I guess.
Well, here's the bottom line.
And if you've got it down at the highway garage, there must have been a reason that you put it in the highway garage.
Probably the code required.
Because we're really trying to protect our investment. Is realistically, that's why people put fire alarm systems in their buildings.
Yeah.
But protect, the investment that we investment. Have here.
Well, here, let me put it this way. What we have here right now has to be inspected, regardless whether it calls out or not.
Yes, yeah. But what I'm saying is the investment that we have here is, if nothing else, it's all the records we have in here. That, you just don't stick a price on.
Exactly. Because there's some stuff that you just can't replace.
Yeah.
Because not everything here in this building has been electronically digitalized.
So I guess, you know, I don't have a problem with the $2,500. If you came back and said, well, if you want to do it, we're direct call to dispatch is $5,000. I'm not sure I have a problem with that either.
Well, once again, I'm just trying to think with my wallet, because I hate going back to this, but it's my wallet too.
You know that phone that you have at the fire station, phone outside the building?
Yep.
That has a dedicated line to it. That has a relay in there.
Yep.
So when you pick up the phone, it automatically dials out 911 and automatically goes to Franklin County Dispatch.
Shelter control, yep.
Relay's about this big.
Yep.
You want an extra one? I just happen to have an extra one sitting in my van that I found in my shop that I was getting ready to throw out. And you can either take it as a replacement for the fire department, or you may be able to use it here and put it in so it'll dial out automatically to Franklin County Dispatch.
I'll take it at the fire department.
You're not being very loyal to the town.
Out of the town.
Once again, this, once again, they have a dial-out system there, which this would be a direct replacement for, and you would be offering up a piece of equipment that presently right now is not in the foresight of being installed in the building. So that is why I would take it at the fire department.
What do we have at the schools?
Myself on that one.
Huh? Pretty good. Out of curiosity, Kevin, what do we have at the schools? Do you know?
Yeah, schools, basically, it's a dial-out system. But it, once again, does not go directly to Shopman Control. It goes through a monitoring system. The monitoring system, in turn, goes ahead. It gets the information. They say, okay, well, it's zone 3 on device 5. So that would tell you, basically, when the fire department shows up, we know to go into what zone. And all of the devices, because the fire department has been very forward-thinking as far as asking for pre-plans to the different buildings. When you go into a building now, depending on where it is, whether it be Harding or the plastics place, what we're trying to do there is have the same exact format there at each of the different buildings. You have a book that opens up. These are where your zones are. These are exactly where your hazmats are. These are where your controls are. These are where your risers are. Mm-hmm. Each one of those, we have a book in the rescue truck, and we also have one at the department itself. So you've got a pullouts. Then again, within these books, because of, depending on the size of the incident, you open up the book inside the 3-ring binder. If you have multiple areas and say, well, I need you to go to zone 4 and zone 5, and you're calling in Turner's and Greenfield, you pull these two out, here you go, zone 4, zone 5. You know exactly where you're going. You know what your deal is. And if all of that, you lose it, we have flash drives too. So again, what I'm kind of going back around to what I'm getting at is the information that comes in to dispatch, or excuse me, control from the monitoring places are able to give more information. And then once that happens, then the information is easier for us, being the fire department, to understand, going to know exactly where we're going and how we're going to look for the devices.
Is there a savings in time having the call go directly to Shelburne?
That I cannot speak to that because I don't know. I would think so. I mean, that would just make common sense.
That's my thought too. And if it's a reasonable expense, I guess what I'm saying is I'd like to know comparison of cuts. You get $2,500 a year.
Right.
You know, if you said it's $5,000.
911 call goes directly to Franklin County Dispatch, and nobody pays for that. All you pay is for that separate line.
I'm not quite so sure. If it dials out 911, if it dials out 911, it depends on how the announcement of your call out system would be. You know, it could very well be if you do a call out right now, strictly a call out that's not through a monitoring service, through the 911 thing, it's going to be because it's just an automated. You have an alarm sounding at whatever Pleasant Street Elementary School, period.
Okay.
So there's no any additional information at that point.
Yeah, I dealt with Wells Fargo with a kind of big system in town. And we found it really handy because they could tell you what zone or where, and you could go troubleshooting. And, you know, so we could often tell the fire department not to bother.
I mean, because once we get there anyway, excuse me, we're going to go to the control board, and the control board is going to tell us exactly where the zone is and which device it should be, is what it should be doing.
Okay. And I guess, you know, it's
depending on.
And a new system. These old ones don't tell you anything.
No, they basically give me an idea, and that's about it.
So you just got to run around the whole building.
Yeah, basically, and just start looking up and trying to figure out.
Brand new system. You can tell right which room it's in.
Exactly.
Yep. We don't want to spend that kind of money.
Part of this, the town clerk wanted more security in her area, and she wanted to, correct if I use the wrong terminology, let me know, Kevin.
Yep.
She wanted a motion detector in her area that would talk to this alarm and therefore talk to somebody outside, but that was tabled for now.
Correct, because the person, because this was just thrown on me basically a week ago. I mean, granted, we've been talking about some different things, a panic button for a while. They talked about a panic button going directly from that office there, the clerk's office, directly into the police department. And the police department said no, because that's going to give you a false sense of security. Simple fact is there may not be anybody in there at that point in time. So, again, that's been kicked back and forth on how they want to go about it. The other thing is, and I don't want to go too deep because it goes into another one, is rekeying of all of the doors. So once we started talking about that at the last department head meeting, then the suggestion was well, what's it going to take to upgrade instead of just rekeying? How about a fob system? That way you know exactly who's going and who's going out, what time and who it is, because the fob will be exactly to the person. So now we're starting to incorporate all these things. The guy was here Friday of last week. I walked through the building with him. We told him exactly what we wanted to do. We wanted key fobs at 1, 2, 3 doors over there for the interior, exterior, in and out. We wanted key fobs at each one of the doors to be able to go into the main offices. Again, all of this would go into a system that would log who's going in, who's going out. The other end of it is once again, going one step further, is they wanted to go ahead and set up a motion detector, or they wanted some kind of security in the clerk's office when it's closed. And the cheapest, easiest way that we figured was a single motion detector. So you set this motion detector in the proper area, and it'll be able to tell if somebody comes in through a window, if somebody comes in through the door, if somebody busts through a wall to be able to get into there, into that area, it would pick it up. Again, that would be tied into the fire alarm system. It would be just off of a separate channel, is what I was told. Now, again, to go one step further, we also talked about what we can do about setting up a, they call it a hold-up button or a panic button, for if they have an issue there, they push the button, and automatically goes out, 911, clerk's office, town hall, town of Deerfield, and then the police is dispatched. So that's pretty much the direction they're looking at. Again, kind of going back to the door locks, or excuse me, the locking system. Again, it all depends on which direction they want to go with. Do you want to go ahead and change out the locks where the keys can only be cut in one place? Or do we want to go cheaper and rekey the entire building, because there's so many keys that are out there over the years, so many masters, I'm assuming, that are out there over the years. And then once you go ahead and you do all that, and then somebody can go ahead and go to Leaders and cut as many keys as they want. Or do we want to go with a more expensive one? Or do you want to go with the key fob system? So this
request here for $6,500 is contemplating which of those options?
Correct.
Well, I'm asking.
Well, which options?
It's just a
re-keying. Re-keying. And re-keying. Is that with... You can only cut...
The more expensive re-keying is what that number
so
is for.
So keys that can only be cut... from one place, you can't just go to Leader, but not the fobs.
Correct.
Okay.
Since this is in your bailiwick, do you have all the information you need to make an informed decision on what's the best way to go?
As soon as I get dollar amounts, yeah.
So you got a dollar amount here, but you don't know.
I don't have because the guy was only here Friday last week. So he has not given me a quote on the fobs or anything else. I mean, if we can go ahead and we can put this together where we'll know exactly who's going in and who's going out of this place all the time for an additional $3,000, then yeah, it's worth it. Is it going to be worth it if it's an additional $50,000? Again, I have no idea where the dollar amount's going to come in until I get the quotes back.
So it's the Capital Improvement Committee who presents the article on town meeting floor.
I couldn't hear you.
It's basically Capital Improvement Committee's article. You're the one that defends it on town meeting floor. It sounds as if we don't have enough information. Would it make sense just to worry about this next year and over the next year just make an informed decision of everything that we need to do?
And that would...
We received two requests, one for the rekey for $6,500,
and one for the FOB system for $36,000.
Yeah, that was
that's what we received.
And that $36,000 was a...
Yeah, that, well, that's the point.
Was a number picked out of the air?
So that should be $36,000.
So to answer your question, do we really want to wait a whole year to do anything?
Well, it's not waiting. It's just the fact that we have town meeting coming up, and as frequently happens, and no, not pointing fingers at anyone, is that we all have a tendency to wait until the last minute, and all of a sudden it's like, oh, I got to get this done, I got to get that done, and there really isn't enough time to give. To give the, you know, to really take the good hard look at it. So, and, you know, we all do.
Is it going to kill us to not rekey this?
That's right. That's my point. Yeah.
Kevin, if you're getting door replacements, aren't you going to be doing different keys for those doors?
No, it's that double set of doors right there, and there's that double set of doors back there, and we were trying to use as much of the old hardware as we could. We were trying to basically keep with the same keys.
No matter what the doors.
You know, should we wait a year? Well, if a year from now nobody broke in and wrecked everything, and we say, yeah, great, good thing we waited. If they come in and use the key in the wrong way, then we're going to be sorry we waited.
Well, the other thing is, if Kevin has a handle on the cost of the basic rekeying at $6,500 and that is passed, and then over the intervening next couple of months, he decides that the $20,000, whatever the number ends up being for the FOB, is really the better way to go, he could hold off and then come back at a future date for that amount or the extra amount he would need. So I do appreciate that. That's the reason why I would be very reluctant to pass the 36, it's less, but if it's the lesser amount and you know, leaning on Kevin to kind of help direct us if he thinks there's a better option that may be a bigger investment, I still think that's something that we have a check and balance on, I guess.
That, like you said, that key fob system may not be the end of all of end all,
right.
You know, and it may not be the best choice for the town.
Right.
Again, you know, it's...
Request
at the last minute, then we jump through the hoops to try and get the numbers to try and put them out.
Well, that's...
It's probably the easiest way I can say it.
The police department, what's their situation over there?
They would also like to be included into the key fob. And
key fob or rekey, or both?
At this point, because of security, I'm not going to answer any questions. I'm sorry.
No, I understand. It's the type of thing where last minute.
You have a system over at the fire station where everything is checked in and out.
Yeah, we've got that over the fire station where we've got the little key fob.
Right.
And you just put it to the door. Door unlocks for you. They're magnetic locks. You're able to go in. It goes ahead and clocks in exactly who's going in, who's going out. Ballpark number, I want to say, was somewhere around 20 to 25,000. But I do believe that also included the cameras, too, and all of the video equipment. So,
okay.
So there's multiple cameras with inside and exterior of the fire department.
The thing right now is that everybody in town can get in and out of this building.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
there isn't anyone that doesn't have some relative that can get in and out of this building.
Well, yeah, I mean, I can get in
here.
The
door.
Right.
I have no keys that would allow me to get into any of the offices, but I'm not sure if I couldn't find someone who had a key if I really...
Or you could just kick it in. I mean, they're not really that secure, are they? I don't know.
Once again, security I'm not going to discuss on TV.
Okay.
Sorry.
Something needs to be done, but...
Yeah, I agree. Is $2,500 or whatever the number is adequate to do that?
$6,500. If you end up going the route of the basic rekeying, do you feel good about the $6,500 number?
Yes. For the rekeying with the better keys.
Right. Yeah. Better
Correct.
Key.
Yes. Because that is the quote that we did right. receive.
Okay.
Explain the better key.
Once again, it's the design of the lock. It's the design of who you're actually getting the materials from. As to whether it's a standard lock, that you can get a key cut anywhere, or it's a like the keys at
your car that has the
no. It's just the style of the key, because like very specifically like the keys for the highway department. The only place I can get keys for that is either through Yale or through Foster Fair in
Northampton.
Mm-hmm. And I have to have a certified letter from Yale stating that I'm allowed to have this key recut.
Okay. And that actually works?
If you try to go ahead and take that key and bring it to anybody else besides a standard lock shop, and probably most of these people, because of the type of key, they would probably have to special order the key.
Okay.
So, and again, some of these are assumptions at this point, so.
I mean, the way the key is for my car, if I need to.
It's got a chip in it.
It's got a, it's not this one, but it has a chip in it.
That's good.
And that sort of makes some sense to me, but I don't know if it, I assume this one does someplace. So
usually
just getting
the key itself.
You know, it doesn't do any good to get a key,
right?
Because you need the communications with the ignition system.
Yep. You know, again, you know, the nice thing about the fobs is you're able to tell exactly who goes in and who goes out. Okay, so you've got 3, 6, you got 7 of you up there right now. Okay, each one of you would get a fob as soon as you came off the committee. Give me back your fob. Oh, I lost it. Well, you know what?
Yes,
go ahead and keep it because it's not going to work anyway. Try and do that with a key.
All right.
Again, it depends on what you want to do, which direction you want to go.
I guess I'd feel more comfortable. I understand some of the issues here, and I would feel more comfortable with that kind of a mechanism. I mean, we do have people who are working in here late at night, and they may be, at that point in time, the only one in the building. So it would be nice to have that kind of security.
Yeah.
Do you think that you'd have the ability to have the quote in order to put a number or to be able to think through the benefits of going to that more expensive system before we get towards town meeting?
Yes. For the fob system?
Yeah.
Yes. I'm anticipating by tomorrow or Thursday at the latest, because I told the guy I was in a push.
Okay. Well, then let's move on from this, because I think that will answer a lot of the things that we're talking about right now.
If that's the direction they want to go in. Again, depending on, I mean, if it's worth it, then yeah, another request will go in. If it's not worth it, then you'll never see it.
All right. So it's your call.
Yeah, pretty much. Okay. Well,
right.
and the select board. I mean, because I'm not the final say on anything here. I'm just, once again, my job, the way I see it is, this is what my job is. This is what I oversee. This is what I need to do my job. Here it is. If you can fund it, that's great. If you can't fund it, then you can't fund it. So how it goes, which directions they go in, is not up to me. It's up to capital, finance, select board, and then the people of the town.
But right now you have the ball.
But right now I got the ball. Okay. For now. Until I hand it off. And I will hand it off.
Okay.
How about the flooring at South County Senior Center?
The bingo hall, which we did approve, was $7,000. The tiles like these, I guess you call them linoleum tiles, they're popping up. They're asbestos. Just concerned about it.
Did they give you a price for removing the asbestos?
Pardon?
They get you a price for removing the asbestos?
No.
No, we're going to overlay.
This is an overlay.
Overlay them?
Yeah. If you encapsulate it, then you don't have to worry about it. If you go ahead and you went to go pull this, again, rough number, pull out of the sky, $14,000. Anyway, because the entire building would have to be shut down. You would have to go ahead and encapsulate it. You'd have to have all this air scrubbers for the people going in and out. You're going to have to pay for the removal of the product. You're going to have to pay for the disposal of the product, which is both extremely pricey, or we can take a piece of linoleum, put it over the top of it, and we're done. Until somebody goes ahead and decides.
Linoleum and a subfloor?
I'm sorry?
Does this incorporate like the little thin subfloor they usually put down and then put the linoleum on it?
This includes the VCT adhesive.
I got it here. You'll know it.
Looks like probably a lot of board.
How large an area are we talking about?
I think that big hall they've got.
Well,
probably 30 by 30.
Same thing.
But 1,000 square feet or?
I can't tell you off the top of my head.
Less than, it's got to be less than. Usually, it's an all classroom, right? Bill,
it's the biggest 20, room 20, on the right.
24 by 30 is about the typical size
about
of it.
About 30 by 30, roughly. Okay. Plus, you got the hallway, plus, you got the bathroom.
Yeah.
Plus,
750 square feet.
Plus, you got the hallway and the backside.
But they're not, are they doing all, yeah, that's true.
That everything's supposed to be done.
Now, with this building, you know, we've been talking about looking at this building for a number of years, and they did some, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, they did take a look at it, and I don't remember what the number was, but it seems to me that it was the only thing they looked at was the outside of the building. And
they looked at the structure is what they
structure,
looked at.
Structure, and they were talking about $1 million for relatively just outside work.
My general understanding, yeah.
Yeah, so it's a question. I think we need to, you know, 5,000, 6,000, whatever the number is, 7,000 isn't a lot of money.
For the one room.
But the question is, what are we going to do with the building?
That is,
I think, you know, I would like to see that.
You or I have the ability to.
The select board has forming another plan around grants.
I have no idea.
That entered into our decision not to approve.
It's all yours for a minute. I'll be right back.
Not to approve a request to replace the tiles of the kitchen area or replace the rug in the lounge area. Because what's going to happen with the building? And tiles in the kitchen area were not that bad.
And they can do a commercial, they can encapsulate with a heavy wax.
And the lounge area, the rug, yeah, it's dirty, but they can get it steam cleaned instead of putting in a whole new rug, at least for another year until they decide what happens to the building. So that was our thinking with those two.
Is the floor so bad that they can't go another year?
The bingo hall?
Yeah.
Tiles are coming up, so people are tripping on them.
We were looking at maybe.
I mean, if walking on it is a problem, then
it's iffy. But based on what the material's made out of, is the concern. Kevin said he's seen little things, dust particles in the air. I don't think that's good. Okay, there. Should we move on?
Well, I guess I definitely see where you're coming from, and I share the concerns. But at the same time, I know that it's often a lot more cost-effective and efficient to do all these things in one shot versus paying someone separately to come in if we do these, you know, back to back to back. Kevin, kind of what are your thoughts on, obviously there's the concern about if there are going to be changes to the senior center that would kind of obviate some of these projects we're doing now versus the efficiency being able to do all three in one shot in the various states of each one.
Oh, certainly. I mean, my own personal opinion, and this is just me coming off of this, the quote unquote, the bingo room, the hall, and the lounge, my opinion, should be done. Capital decided to go with the bingo hall or the bingo room in the hall, because that's basically how they're just claiming this as.
Okay.
Again, my opinion is obviously the bingo room in the hall for the $7,000. In my opinion, for the lounge area, which was like $5,000, the carpet that's in there is extremely old. Because I am still going to go forward through you, and I, as a department head, is still going to go through to the select board requesting that at least the lounge area be done. Mm-hmm. It's an older carpet, whole nine yards. It's nasty. They used to serve food in there. Have they gone through and cleaned the carpet before? Yes, they have. Again, you're looking at $11,000. $11,000 for the health of our seniors that are going in there and the other people that are utilizing.
I think that's cheap money, personal opinion. Anybody else can figure out how they want to look at it. But the way I see it, the kitchen area for the $2,100 or $2,500, that's extremely cheap money at that point, you know, because if you're already spending that, the other $2,000 to go ahead and finish off the entire thing, sure. But again, can that part right there wait, the $2,000? Yes, it most certainly may. But again, going between the $7,000 and the $5,000, that $12,000, I think that's good money spent on what it is for what it is. Because realistically, what are you going to do with the senior center? We've talked about the senior center. We've had different people come in and look at it. We've had different reports look at it. We're absolutely zero distance farther than we were 3 years ago when we looked at all these things. How much longer is it going to be before we go ahead and do something with the senior center? With all of the things that are up and coming in town, with the school roof and this and that, and the library, the whole nine yards, realistically, is the town willing to or able to or even have the appetite to go ahead and build another senior center or something else? You know, once again, you're going back into the crystal ball. But I'm looking, the way I look at it is short term, this is still good money spent for what it is.
Do we have anything after this item here, or are we going to adjourn?
How do we share this with the other two towns?
I'm sorry?
Because it's our building, we have to take
that. That is correct. It's our building. It's a town building, so we have to maintain it.
Okay.
My understanding is the other towns contribute in some form or fashion. How they do that, once again, is not my area, and I do not know how or how much.
Formula is 50% by Deerfield, 25% by Sunderland, 25% by Whately.
But not
any improvements to the building are supposed to be paid by all three towns.
Perfect.
The what?
Then I say do all three areas.
I didn't say that again,
the
John.
The capital improvements done by all three towns?
Let's replace the windows, too, while we're at it.
What we do? Okay, we build
so that's something that we'll need to talk to Doug to verify to make sure that we understand how it's coming. Kevin, thank you for your input on kind of how you differentiate between these three areas. And John, you as well, because I do share the concerns that you guys had about how does this fit in to the bigger picture. This is sort of the hard part, is where do we kind of fall out between doing all three, doing none, or doing some number in between.
Again, personal opinion, at the very least, the very least, you got to do the bingo hall.
Okay.
Because like I said, we've got pieces that are chipping up.
Right.
And it's a hazardous material, period.
So to repair that or to do whatever you want to do, what are we actually doing? If, you know, John mentioned,
we're going to put a cover over the top of it.
With a piece of
linoleum.
Plywood first.
Not necessarily.
No.
You can put straight linoleum right over the top of it.
Linoleum or vinyl?
Vinyl.
You can go up and buy vinyl for something like $2 a square foot.
You'd be more than willing to install it. That would be absolutely phenomenal. I'd appreciate it. These are the prices that we came up with right now. I don't know what to tell you on the dollars. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be rude, but we can pick this apart for the next 200 years.
The labor is about roughly three grand.
So we're not just putting vinyl
for the 70 out of the 70.
So we're not just going to roll out vinyl on top of it.
No, because there's
something else going in.
There's a 4x9 in the kitchen area. There's 9 sheets of 4x8 ply rockwood.
Well, that's my point.
In the lounge, there's 19 pieces.
Okay.
But here's the part I don't understand is according to the bingo hall in the room, they're only calling for one.
One what?
One big one.
So there's definitely a mistake there. But it's one at a set price of $960 compared to 19 pieces at $32.
Okay, well,
4x8s.
And they're 4x8 sheets.
Yeah.
So there's the subflooring, the prep, the labor, the installation, the adhesive.
So there is a subfloor.
That's the way I look at this,
If there wasn't that, everything that's underneath would transfer right up through the vinyl floor. You have to have a subfloor on that.
Yep.
didn't think that.
Well, thank you.
Okay, one last item, and I don't think we have to talk about it much as we talked about it with the guys last week, the replacement ambulance. John, do you have anything to add?
I just like, again, I want to go back to the spreadsheet. I don't know what it's supposed to portray. There's one thing, we voted at the special town meeting, the school, as we all know, and $10,000 for a rate study for the sewer. That's not on here. So I'm assuming with those not being on here, this is portraying what's going to be voted at the next town meeting?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. With that being said, the replacement ambulance is, the total cost is $285,000. So this is portraying all three towns' cost instead mm-hmm. of just the Deerfield share.
Right.
According to the agreement, the town of Deerfield votes whether to buy the ambulance or not. So that's why Doug put it on here at full price. I think right. you're going to get a lot of questions at town meeting as what the 285 means if you show that to the voters.
Well, it would have to, I think it would have to be explained, but right. it's the point there is it's coming out of retained earnings.
Yeah.
Which comes from
all. And I would assume that all three towns will end up having to vote this or the.
I got the impression the way they talked that as only a fiduciary
one that votes is the finance
agency.
Committee from Deerfield and the Deerfield town meeting, and the others just contribute the money right. and they don't vote on it.
Right.
That's right.
Yep. Yeah.
Right.
Well, let me give you my viewpoint on this if you got 2 minutes.
Sure.
Thanks. Excuse me just a second. I don't mean to be rude. Are you guys done with me?
Yep.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Cool.
Can I ask you to stay here?
Yeah, we want to talk to you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So much for that.
We fairly surely close.
First of all, SCAMS has $502,973. You're planning on spending $57,899 for our administrative functions for this town for this year. They want to maintain an operating reserve of $100,000. They want a capital purchase an ambulance, $285,000. And then they have an offset. They want to keep another $60,000. So that's $60,000 in addition to $100,000 for an operating reserve. And then they give you a cost for this ambulance. The chassis in a box is $260,000. Figure the trade-in value is $15,000, so you take $15 off of $260. That brings it down to $245. And then they say equipment's going to cost $40,000, so they're back up to $285,000. Now, the concerns I have is this. SCEMS has been in existence for going on a third year. They're supposed to be setting operational administrative goals. I don't think they've done that yet. They're supposed to establish a capital plan, and I don't believe they've done that yet. And the plan that they told us before was that they're going to replace the ambulance in 2018. Now, why are they going to replace it in 2017 now? Because they just happen to have $285,000 they want to blow. But meanwhile, they have $51,000 that they put aside for the ambulance in 2015 and another $51,000 in 2016. And you add that $100,000 on top of this $285,000, and then another $40,000 to equip it, you're talking $440,000.
Mm-hmm.
Now, to me, there's something wrong with what's going on here. They're giving you a lot of lip service. They're giving you a runaround. They're not giving you a real good plan for anything other than let's blow the money because let's do it now so we get more involved in this SCEMS operation. And that bothers me.
Okay.
Now, let me give you an example of something that I was given somewhere. I have a picture of an ambulance. I got this information from the guy by the name of Wynn, who used to be the fire chief in Greenfield. He's gone down to Osterville. I got a picture of an ambulance, which is brand new, totally off the thing, fully loaded for $280,000. So here we've got $51,000 hidden, $51,000 hidden, $285,000, and another $40,000. One of my questions tomorrow night is, What the hell are you doing? You're adding on top of adding on top of adding, and you don't, there's no plan. Your plan says you're going to buy in 2018. What's the panic to do it now? The bottom line is, I think, if anything, we should vote the retained earnings down, because that doesn't make sense. It only makes sense because they over-budgeted so much for the first year that they get to blow the money now. That's what they're trying to do.
And they're going
to
do the same thing.
And they're going to do the same thing again next year.
Yep,
this year.
Because they're going to still have another $400,000 because they're still so far over going into this next year. So the bottom line is, I just don't feel very comfortable about what's going on. This is the ambulance that they're getting in Osterville. $280,000, fully loaded. And here, we've gotten a budget, $51,000, $285,000, another $40,000 to fix it up.
Well, the 51, the 51 is part of the retained earnings.
Yeah, so just to...
Yeah, not into retained earnings.
So I don't think that there's a cost discrepancy between what different people have talked about this going to cost and their estimation of it being around $245,000, including the trade. And I think that makes sense. And the $51,000 that have been set aside, the problem that they're trying to fix, I think, this fall is to actually set up an account for capital, because right now all it is one pot of retained earnings. So the $51,000 that they've set aside are part of the $502,000 that we're looking at here. I think you do raise a good point about them moving it up a year from 18 to 17. And I'm hopeful that there's a public presentation tomorrow from SCEMS, and hopefully they'll shed even more light on that from the conversation we had last week. So I do agree that that's something we do need to look at.
Well, there's also $51,000 in the FY16, the current budget,
or
set aside for the ambulance as well.
Right, and that's part of the number that we tried to go through to estimate what their FY16 retained earnings might end up looking like.
Mm-hmm.
So I agree that's in there, but the fact that they're fully requesting the 285 here for the ambulance plus the medical equipment to staff it, I don't really think it matters which pots of money they're using. Either way, they're going to be spending 285 out of retained earnings.
Well, they could, in fact, if they really wanted to, since we have three ambulances and they all have to be replaced eventually. By the time the year's up, they'll probably have enough money so that they could buy three brand new ambulances out of retained earnings.
Well, I don't think that that's particularly helpful, but
well, neither do I.
No, I don't think your comment is particularly helpful to the conversation we're trying to have.
In what way?
Well, I think that we've had a lengthy discussion about the retained earnings, and I think that there is a fair amount of variability around what they're projected to be. I think that, frankly, the truth is somewhere probably between where you and Mark are both estimating. And, you know, I do think that's an issue that needs to be addressed, because you're right that this service has had a couple of years now to kind of tighten up their budgeting process. They've made some progress, but I think many people feel they have not made enough. And I think that they really are going to have to give a good presentation tomorrow and again at town meeting to get the people of the town to want to support continuing in the direction that they've been going. I'm hopeful that between their presentation and our feedback and anybody else who stands up and speaks for or against them, the town can have a good perspective on where the service is going. I think we got some answers on the replacement schedule. They are targeting every 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at the longevity of the fleet right now, I don't think it's crazy to look to replace one when we saw how long each of these has been in service. But I agree that it is a change from their previous plan.
I just want to add one. The one they want to replace is 17 years old, so it's
right.
It's due.
Well,
according to them.
Yeah, the argument.
Life of an ambulance. Weren't even supposed to have the third one.
Pardon?
They weren't even supposed to have.
I'm not getting into that.
Well, that's part of the discussion, though.
Yeah, but that's no. I don't think that's is that in.
I do find it interesting, though.
Improvement planning committee. How many ambulances they should have? I guess it is.
Yeah, I would.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, now that I think about
having
it.
Having the third ambulance is going to cost them $300,000 every 10 years, in addition to what they're funding now.
No,
well, they justified the need for three. We're going to go through this tomorrow night.
To buy the ambulance.
No, it's not. They're going to buy an ambulance every 5 years, regardless of how many they have. The difference will be the length, the longevity of the fleet.
The third one, yeah.
That's the only difference.
The only thing now,
there's indirect costs of other things that you have to do in order to have the ambulance, whether it's in inspections and insurance and things like that, which are some cost. My biggest concern about the third ambulance is any change to the staffing plans, because that's where the costs get out of control in a hurry.
Mm-hmm.
And that is clarity I'm certainly looking for as we consider these different plans.
Our understanding was the third ambulance is going to be used for backup.
Right.
It's just going to sit there.
Spare tire.
And get cobwebs unless they need it.
Right.
The one place where they've used it, and it is an area that I can appreciate, it shows up at high school football games.
They get money for that.
Well, yeah, but not enough to cover the cost of the ambulance. But the question then is, and that's really the only place that I've seen that. Now, maybe there are other places.
Well, why not bring the other one
over? And the answer there is, well, if we take the other one, it's no longer available for service. They can't staff the second one at this point in time anyway. So that's, so I question even the advisability of having three ambulances. They can't staff the second one. Why do you need three?
Well, they gave us the impression a year ago that the state basically told them, it's not worth anything. You might as well stick it in the garage if you got it and hold on to it.
Well, they stuck it in the garage and now they want a brand new one.
The new one is going to replace the second one in the fleet and become the primary. And then the Deerfield one will be the second one. What?
And replace the first one.
So the eight-year-old that is currently the primary will become the secondary.
Right.
The 12-year-old that is currently the secondary will become the tertiary. And the 17-year-old will be gone and the new one will be the new one.
And I'll bet somebody will want to save that for parts.
But I also find it interesting that we have three towns, and what's the youngest age of an ambulance? 8 years.
Yeah.
And yet, at the same time, now we're going to replace ambulances every 5 years. So if you got an ambulance at 8 years old, an ambulance at 12 years old, and an ambulance at 17 years old, why didn't these towns replace their own ambulances at 5 years? Because they couldn't afford it. That's the bottom line.
Because they want town of Deerfield to pay.
So now all of a sudden we're here in this situation and we're going to replace ambulances every 5 years. It makes you think a little bit. Or at least it does me.
Good point.
All right, well,
but that's for
right somebody else.
For this committee, it's for next year.
Well, this is part of why we did not vote the SCEMS budget last week or this week, nor are we voting these now. We're going to be able to, hopefully a lot of people here and watching at home will be able to go to the comment or presentation session tomorrow and get a little bit more clarity on some of these issues.
So what is speaking of that, what is your understanding of that meeting tomorrow?
I mean, they have not done it before, to my knowledge. So, I mean, I took it to be something akin to when the schools will have a public presentation of their budgets, though, having never been to one, I do not know what the format will be.
There is no oversight board meeting tomorrow night.
Okay.
So, presumably, the oversight board won't be there for us to talk to.
I do not know the roster of individuals who'd be making the presentation. I would imagine Zach would be there, and I would imagine that some other people will be there that are members of the oversight board.
What time is that meeting? What time is that meeting? I believe
it's at 7.
7.
In the Whately Town office. Right?
And it's posted as, I think, a select board meeting.
Deerfield Select Board is a meeting.
Right.
Scheduled.
It's on the Deerfield.
But there's no.
I saw it in the paper as far as the regional also, but.
No oversight committee meeting scheduled. There's no posting for an oversight board meeting.
In the email, I thought it addressed.
Maybe it'll just be a chance meeting.
Right. It addressed the select boards and finance committees and oversight board. I think whoever shows up. I don't think there's a direct invitation or anything.
No, I think I thought the oversight board would be there so that you know, if somebody has questions, you can ask the oversight board.
But why do you think that they won't be there?
There's no meeting posted. That's simple.
Okay.
May I? If they were to show up and meet, they would be an illegal meeting.
Right.
Please, Kevin.
All right. Yeah. According to the town website, there is a public presentation of South County EMS Wednesday from 7 to 9, the Whaley Town Office, 4 Sandy Lane. Presentation will review the operational plans, budget proposal of South County EMS. The public is invited.
It's just a review.
That's all I got out of it.
Okay. No, that much is, yeah.
Do you hear?
Well, if the select boards of the towns are going to be there, then a number of the oversight board members will be there to begin with.
Right.
And, you know, look, I share the frustrations of some other people here with the South County budget still. I think there's a lot of things that kind of jump out at me that give me concerns about the long-term viability of the budget. You know, there's a lot of short-term things going on. I find this year especially a kind of lot of very large moves of spending a lot of money on ambulance a year before schedule, of having an operational budget that's going up, of using very temporary measures in order to make the town assessments go down this year, but leaving it in a position where I really don't know what the FY18 budget might look like. Mm-hmm. So I share the concerns that, you know, I'm certainly not there yet, and I'm going to be looking very closely and listening very closely to what's said tomorrow night.
Of course there is.
So, does anyone else have anything else before we call it a night?
I've got that number for you if you want.
Which number?
For the year. Second operator.
Please, sir.
For FY16.
Yeah.
Second operator should have been $41,823, not $40,152.
All right.
Should have worked out too. Because presently right now, if he's going up to 2083, then his rate should be 2003 last year. You take that times 2088, comes up to 41,822.64.
I'm sorry, Kevin, what would
The hourly rate was 20.03.
Yep.
In FY16. So his rate should have been $41,823.
Okay, so he went from, for FY16 you're talking about, he should have been 41,823 going up to 43,493.
That is correct.
And then the other one?
The 1923 yeah. should be correct. The 1923 times 2088.
Gives you?
40,152.
Right. So numbers.
We'll check those with Doug. It's been a long night. Let's not get caught up on that right now because we can sort that out easily tomorrow. Our next meeting would be planned again for next Tuesday, April 5th. We'll plan to go over a number of other budgets as we did at the beginning of this meeting that we've looked at before, and then hopefully start with a kind of budget overview and also start to talk about some of these warrant articles that we talked about today.
Just
one question.
Yes.
When's the South Deerfield Fire District meeting?
Wednesday.
I'm sorry?
When's the South Deerfield Fire District meeting?
Next Wednesday, the 6th.
The annual meeting?
Yeah.
Annual meeting.
And very quickly, just there's a select board has tentatively scheduled a pre-town meeting to be held on April 12th, 2016. Dylan referred to this at the beginning of the meeting, and that's to review this budget and also all special and annual town meeting warrant articles. And if anybody's listening out there, I would strongly suggest that you attend this meeting because I think you'll have a lot of questions, concerns, and there'll also be a lot of information that will make the official town meeting, the special town meeting go a little smoother, I think.
Yeah, thank you, Jeff. That's a very good point. Thank you for pointing that out. You know, for us on our committee, we're going to be meeting on the 5th and then the following week on Monday, the 11th, so that we are as prepared as we can be for that public session. I personally, unfortunately, will not be able to attend on the 12th, but, you know, we'll have gotten through a lot of what we need to on our end. And then the other thing, as we're talking about dates, and we mentioned the 6th, the select board has thrown out the 6th as a date for us to meet with them in a joint meeting. They are meeting that night anyway, and so we would be on their agenda the way that we were at the end of last year. Doug and Mark and myself will try to put together a at least rough agenda, so it's not just topic free for all. So if there's things that we all think we definitely want on there, and we can talk about this next week, mm-hmm. let's, you know, make sure we know what those things are.
Make sure you put down salary adjustments for the COLA.
That is already on there, absolutely.
And major sewer project funding.
Okay.
Because there's a difference of opinion on this board as to how major projects should be funded down there. And my opinion is that we receive 20 to 25% of our tax base from commercial and industrial endeavors in this town. And they came here for the sewer, and yet we're gonna spend all their money, but we're not gonna spend any money on the sewer. I think that's wrong.
Okay, well, we'll certainly put that on there. I think it's a good topic to bring up.
Needs to be discussed.
Yeah. Right. Anybody else? You know, if over the next week or so you think of other topics you want to put on there for that joint meeting, let me know. We'll be, you know, kind of putting all those together.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Thank
Second.
You. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thanks, guys. Long night. We got a lot done.